At first, like, I didn't want to share too much about my life. I didn't want to explain, like, my age, of course. I didn't want to say it because I didn't want people on the internet to see me vulnerable.
Everyone, I'm your host, Alanized, and this is Noche de Pendejadas, your favorite talk show turned podcast, en donde yo traigo a tus influencers favoritos para platicar y posiblemente sacarles sus trapitos al sol. Please help me welcome my guest tonight, Meche! Hello, hello, amiga, ¿cómo estás?
Oh my God. Hello.
I am so excited to have Meche with us tonight. Amigas, this has been a long time in the making. Pienso que teníamos que grabar este episodio cuando hace como 6 meses, güey.
Sí, hace como 6 meses.
Literal. La última vez que yo y la Meche íbamos a grabar, you guys, la Meche terminó en el hospital. I think you had ate in a hot Cheeto. ¿Qué te comiste? Cuéntanos qué pasó ahí, amiga.
Bueno, pues el día que íbamos a grabar, I took the one chip challenge, mm-hmm. The day before, but I did it while I was on my period, so that fucked up my whole stomach. I was like, no, I'm sorry, I have to put myself first.
No, literally, y lo hiciste, amiga, está bien, yo también lo hubiera hecho. Tuvieron la ambulance, también yeah. Fue, ¿no?
Yeah.
Se hizo todo esto, pero lo bueno que hoy la tenemos aquí, amigas. Después de tanto que ustedes me la estaban pide y pide, we finally made it happen. Y pues igual que ustedes están rete emocionados, pues también yo de conocerte un poquito más, de conocer tu historia, and just know more about Meche. Antes de que empecemos con el chisme, yo te voy a pasar el micrófono a ti, amiga, okay, para que nos cuentes un poquito más de quién eres y qué haces.
Hola, pues me presento, yo soy Marisa, pero soy conocida como Meche, tengo 17 años y soy cantante. Ah, no, no es cierto. Bueno, hago música y también hago redes sociales.
You've been getting into a little bit of everything. Obviamente nos cuentas de que tienes música, que vamos a hablar de eso más en adelante. Do you remember the first time we met? Was it at Blessive's party?
It was at
Blessive's Halloween party, you guys. Blessive's me acuerdo party. Que esa noche yo ni en cuenta que ibas a venir, güey. Uh-huh. Llegaste tú ya cuando yo ya me iba.
Sí.
Do you remember? I remember we were at Blessive Alex's birthday party, you guys. Yo pienso que era su cumpleaños, era en tiempo de Halloween. Sí. Y yo ya pienso que yo ya me iba cuando llegaste tú con Gia.
Uh-huh.
And I was like, oh shit, yo no me esperaba que estuvieras ahí, güey. Like, I literally didn't. That was like our first time meeting.
Yeah.
And then te volví a ver que en la fiesta de Shari.
De Shari.
De uh-huh. Shari, ya después de eso ya no te he visto hasta hoy.
Ya
so
sé.
I'm so excited de tenerla aquí, amigas. Y vamos a empezar con el chisme. Vamos a empezar con todo. La primera pregunta que yo le pregunto a todos, que te voy a preguntar a ti, es: ¿cómo fue Meche growing up?
Te voy a platicar todo, pero antes tenemos que cantar tu intro.
Yes, oh my God, yes. Díganme por qué Meche was like, tenemos que cantar tu canción, tenemos que cantar tu canción. Yo ya me estaba haciendo pendejo, para no cantarla. Pero la vamos a cantar because we have a video.
We have a
de
video.
La segunda vez que nos miramos, donde estábamos cantando la canción. You had told me that you used to watch me back in the day.
Yeah,
huh?
I'm a fan. I'm
oh,
a fan.
Thank you. Yo también soy fan tuyo. Vamos a empezar con la canción, amigas. El himno de muchas de ustedes, de la familia Metiche. A la una, a las dos, a las one, two, three. Sí. Let's go.
¿Cómo estás, pinche pendeja? Vete a la verga, pinche pendeja.
Mamá verga, pinche pendeja. ¡Ea, ea, ea! I always like to like stop singing it halfway para ver qué tanto bien se la saben. Y la Meche pasó la prueba. Ah, ahora sí, amigas, vamos a empezar con el chisme. Quiero saber cómo fue Meche growing up. ¿Cómo fue tu infancia? Cuéntanos de eso.
Ok, pues I grew up in Mexico.
Mm-hmm.
Until I was about 7 years old, that's when I finally came to the United States. But my mom actually left a year before we left.
Oh,
me and my
okay,
brother.
Okay.
Yeah, it was only me and my little brother at the time. There was like a whole year where it was just me and my brother.
Yeah.
Like we would usually stay like with my dad, with my biological dad. And then we would go between him and my grandma's yeah. house. So it was like my mom wasn't there for like a whole year because they got divorced. So she came here to like work as she would clean houses.
Yeah.
And then it was just like me taking care of like my brother.
¿Te afectó eso, el de que tu mamá pues los dejó por mucho tiempo? Like during that time, that whole year que sí se fue, like la extrañabas. Sí. Like did you be like, oh, ya quiero que regrese mi mamá o cuando sí. nos vamos con ella? ¿Cómo fue eso para ti?
Pienso que fue difícil. Siento que sí fue difícil, especialmente porque yo estaba más pequeña. Y luego, pues, mi papá casi no nos hacía caso. Era como que, ah, existen, ok, qué chido.
Ahí está, ya.
¡Qué padre! Pero no era como que nos cuidaba o nada de eso. Entonces, siento que él como que me obligó a crecer. Pero no solo para crecer, pues, para cuidarme a mí misma, sino también porque tenía que cuidar al otro huerquío, a mi hermano. Entonces... No, pues siento que sí me afectó, pero siento que me hizo quien soy hoy.
Tu papá estuvo presente por un poco tiempo en tu vida, pero también me estabas contando mientras que nos estábamos arreglando que tu papá dejó de estar completamente en tu vida. ¿Qué pasó ahí? Cuéntanos qué pasó con la relación de tu papá.
Pues la verdad es que cuando nosotros nos vinimos para acá fue como que decirle adiós totalmente. Realmente él nunca estuvo presente, o sea, sí estábamos con él, pero no es como que nos hablara o nada, era como, nada más estaba ahí como...
Like, nomás sabías que era tu papá, pero no actuaba o no lo sentías bien, como papi,
No, nunca tuve esa relación con él. Tuve esa relación con mi abuelo, no con mi papá. Mi papá nunca estuvo. Mi papá, es que él también tenía otra familia.
Entonces,
como él tenía otra familia, pues casi no nos hacía caso a nosotros. Éramos yo y mi hermano Alejandro, casi no nos hablaba.
Did that affect you, el saber que pues tenías papá, pero no lo sentías como que lo tenías?
Siento que no me afectó, especialmente cuando ya mi mamá nos trajo después de un año de ella irse acá, o venirse para acá, no me afectó. Siento que ya ni lo sentía. Era como que, ah, ok, bueno, al menos ahora tengo a mi mamá presente. Yeah. Que ella sí nos cuida, ella sí nos da de comer, ella sí nos baña o lo que sea.
Me estabas contando también que tu papá falleció a una temprana edad. ¿Qué pasó ahí? Cuéntanos un poquito de eso. If you feel comfortable talking about it.
Yo no sé mucho ese tema. Yo nada más sé que él se murió solo. Una vez lo encontraron y ya estaba muerto. Creo que se había morido, se murió o falleció por... que él fumaba mucho. Entonces, como que él tuvo un problema y ya eso...
Lo afectó.
Ajá, lo mató.
Like, you feel like him smoking, like, caused an illness que luego lo llevó a que muriera.
Y él nunca... He never went to, like, fix it out or, like, get it checked at the doctors or anything. So he kind of just died slowly, I don't know.
That's very sad, you know. Obviamente, yo te estaba platicando off camera. Tengo a similar story, pero con el hermano de mi mamá que falleció hace poco, literal, hace como 2 años. He was a heavy drinker. I think his liver, like, got fucked up to the point where, like, literal, like, he shit out all his intestines. Me acuerdo que mi mamá contó que había ido al baño and he took long in the restroom. Like, ya tenía como dolores de estómago, like, days prior. Like, no, sigue diciendo, like, me duele bien el estómago, me duele. And it got to the point that un día que fue a la casa de mi abuelita, entró al baño and he was taking long. So my other tío and my tía were like, let's check up on him. Like, there's no way he can be in the restroom for like 2 hours, right? Like, ¿qué tanto está cagando, you know? And cuando se metieron al baño, you know, vieron que pues ya estaba fallecido, ya había muerto en el baño, like, all his intestines, like, se le salieron de él. Did that affect you? Obviamente agarras la noticia que tu papá fallece. ¿Cómo te dijeron que falleció?
Mi mamá me dijo.
¿Cuándo falleció o ya later?
No estoy segura. Creo que unos días. No, porque a él falleció y no lo encontraron luego porque él vivía solo.
Oh, okay.
Entonces, días después que los vecinos se dieron cuenta de que olía mal, que algo, pues que él no salía ya, no fumaba, entonces fueron a checarlo y él ya estaba muerto. Entonces, yo no sé cuándo eso pasó exactamente. Mi mamá no me dio muchos detalles, realmente no me importa. Solo sé que se murió y pues me dieron la noticia. Mi mamá me dijo a mí, me dijo, ¿estás bien? O sea, ¿te sientes mal? Si quieres llorar, estoy aquí. Y yo así de que... No, o sea, no quiero llorar, o sea.
También me estabas platicando que a los 5 años fallece tu abuelito en México, ¿verdad? Sí. ¿Cómo pasó eso?
So I've actually never shared this story before, like, anywhere. It's actually, it's kind of emotional, but I'll do it because this is a special podcast. My grandpa, I actually have a tattoo of him, like, right here. Can the camera see it?
Yes. Oh, that's so cute. What was his name?
Juan.
Juan, okay, the J.
Juan Gaitán. So he actually passed away. It was such a crazy thing. Like, honestly, to this day, I still can't believe it.
Yeah.
Because me and my grandpa, like, we were like this. We were like this. Like, I don't know. I loved him so much. And plus, I was the first granddaughter. Because, like, I was literally the first out of everything. Like,
so hasta
first.
Más amor te tenía. Uh-huh. Yeah, la primerita.
And it was only me for, like, those few years that he was alive. it was only me. Yeah, yeah. So it was only me getting everything.
Hey, all the love. Yeah, yeah.
I got everything. Like, he would buy me everything. He would take me everywhere. And I still remember these things, yeah, thankfully. And then one day, this is crazy. He was a trailero, right? And then there was a guy. He had like his truck, and he was driving it in a highway. And I, not a highway, but like those where you can go like fast.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I guess like some guy wanted to, like, he was crazy. He wanted to kill himself. So he was in a bike, and his plan was, he literally ran into the traffic to get killed because he wanted to kill himself. Yeah, you, yeah, know, I guess that's the only way he found or whatever. I don't really know. And then, but the driver that was happening was my grandpa. I was like, fuck, like, out of all cars,
le tocó estar ahí at the wrong time. Yeah, yeah.
Damn it, man.
His car was the only car that hit that person.
Yeah. No, but the thing is that he didn't hit him. So, okay, so my grandpa is driving, whatever. And then, because my tío was there, but he survived. Mm. Yeah, so he's seen
everything. He was passenger?
Yeah, he was passenger, princess. So my grandpa was driving, and I guess this guy como que se le mete. And my grandpa goes like, and he like goes, and he went and crashed like somewhere. And the crash was so bad that he like snapped his neck.
Oh my God. Yeah. ¿Y ustedes cómo se dieron cuenta de lo que había pasado?
My tío came out alive out of that crash. So they called the ambulance. The ambulance called us. And the thing is that I picked up the phone. So I pick up the phone, and they're telling me, and then they just like tell me to give the phone to my mom. My mom's like going insane. She's like, put your shoes on, we're leaving. We get in the car and we go, and we literally are watching how the ambulance is grabbing my grandpa and taking him.
Oh, I was like, God. And then how was, I was that there. Y obviamente tú tenías que 5 años en ese tiempo. Yeah. ¿Cómo fue para ti ver eso? Because it might have been algo it fuerte. Yeah, it was traumatizing.
And to this day, I have the picture in my head. And you know what's crazy? And it's because you're going to call me crazy. But from what I remember my grandpa being like he was laying on the floor. And then he like, they were like grabbing him in those like camitas.
Yeah.
And my grandma was also there. And my grandma was standing right in front of him. But in, for some reason, I remember that he was standing right behind my grandma. But he was also laying down. I don't know.
You probably did see, like, his spirit, like,
yeah,
leaving,
like,
him.
I could swear to God that from, in my memory, that's what I remember.
¿Y cómo fue después de eso? You know, obviamente, lo llevan al hospital. Did he die instantly?
No, he didn't. I think they tried keeping him alive for a few days, but it was just because I couldn't even go in because they were like, you're too young, you can't, yeah, get in. So I couldn't really ever see him after that. My mom did get to say bye to him, but I didn't.
¿Cómo te dijeron a ti la noticia? Obviamente, like, he's in the hospital y tú todavía tienes la ilusión que salga vivo, pero pasan cosas y termina muriéndose. How does your mom tell you the noticia?
We were all laying down, and then I remember, like, my mom just coming in. She sits down right next to me, and she's like, oh, like, he didn't make it, like, you know. And I was like that moment, I don't know how to explain it. It's because it
te afectó, you don't know how to take it. Yeah,
yeah, it's a feeling that you can't explain. Like, you just understand if it happens to you. Like, I don't know, it just like broke, I don't know, it broke me. Like, I was like, what? And sometimes I still cry about him. Like, to this day, I still cry about him because I'm like, damn.
Cuando ya fallece, lo entierran. Do you feel like it was hard for you to grieve? Like, was it hard for you to accept? Obviamente, estaba super chiquita cuando pasó. ¿Fue difícil para ti aceptar lo que había pasado?
100%. Like, honestly, to this day, I'm still like, damn, like, that guy, like, he wanted to kill himself. And he ended up
killing your grandpa.
Yeah. And it's crazy because after the whole thing, that family tried to sue us.
No way.
Yeah.
For what? For almost killing their, yeah, person?
And we were just like they wanted, because I guess whenever, I think, I'm not sure why, I don't really remember why they were trying to sue us, but I do remember that they were trying to sue us, like, for, like, mental, like how it affected him mentally or something like that.
The person, yeah, that was in the bike?
Mm-hmm.
No mames, so el güey se quería matar, no lo hizo, terminó muriendo tu abuelito, and they still were trying to make it seem like it caused him emotional, yeah, damage?
Yeah.
That's crazy. You know, obviamente nos cuentas de que también tu papá murió. Do you feel like esta muerte te afectó mucho más que la muerte de tu papá?
Oh, yeah. I was really close to my grandpa. Yeah. Like, me and my grandpa, it was me and him against the whole world. Like, we were, like, for lifers. Not having him around was, like, I honestly, yeah, my head couldn't comprehend. Like, I was just, like, I can't believe it. Like, this is not real. Yeah. dude, there's no way this is real. Like, I just couldn't. I was like, no, there's no way. I don't believe it. And then with my dad, I was just like, okay, well, first of all, he was alive for how many years? And he didn't even try calling. He didn't even try nothing. He had contact. He had our contact. But he never...
Entonces, tu papá, cuando pudo estar ahí, tampoco no estuvo. So, like, he would never even call you guys.
He literally only called me once. And it was my birthday that one year that I left. I think I was turning... seven or eight, somewhere that I don't remember exactly, but he called to say happy birthday, and then the next year he didn't, and then the next year he didn't, and then the next year he just didn't. I just forgot about him. Like, honestly, like, he kind of just taught me how to live without him. Yeah. Since I was in his house.
A los 7 años te mudas de México a los Estados Unidos, obviamente. A los seis, siete años
por
te
ahí.
Mudas de México a los Estados Unidos, y nos estabas contando que por ese año tu mamá sí vino para acá para trabajar. ¿Te acuerdas todavía la llamada donde tu mamá te dijo, mija, ya se vienen pronto? Do you remember cómo les dieron la noticia que te ibas a ir tú ya para acá?
No me acuerdo exactamente muy bien, o sea, exactamente palabra por palabra, pero sí me acuerdo que mi mamá llegó un día y llegó en la noche. Era súper noche.
¿Se regresó para México?
No, sí, se regresó para México.
Oh, ok, ok.
Y era súper noche. Y luego, de repente, me dice como que agarra tus cosas, ya nos vamos. Y yo así de que, ¿qué? Y ella de que sí. Y ya había terminado mi escuela, ya había terminado el año escolar. Entonces yo así de que, ok. Y luego me acuerdo que nos fuimos y yo solamente miré así de que todas las calles. Y yo, en mi mente, nada más me acuerdo que yo pensaba de que ya, adiós, no voy a volver. Bye, bye.
¿Llegaste a Texas en ese tiempo también? How was that for you? Obviamente, a los 6, 7 años ya estás un poquito más como alert and knowing your surroundings. ¿Cómo fue para ti, obviamente, the transition of going from living in Mexico to now living in the United States? ¿Fue difícil para adaptarte a ti?
Bueno, yo llegué aquí y mi mamá me metió en una escuela en donde no hablaban español. Y yo era una niña que no hablaba inglés.
Puro,
o sea,
español.
Para nada.
Ya.
O sea, era un idioma de que nada que ver. O sea,
ni el jaló.
No. Bueno, o sea, a lo mejor
el jaló y el vaya, lo básico. Y el fuck you.
Y el love you. Nada, eso es todo. No sabía nada de inglés. Entonces mi mamá me mete a una escuela en donde no hablan español. Y creo que ni mi maestra hablaba español. Entonces yo estuve en una situación de que era o aprendía inglés o me quedaba así, pues, sin aprender nada.
Sin aprenderlo, ya. Yeah.
En esa escuela nomás había 3 muchachos que hablaban español. Bueno, sí había varios, pero de los que yo me juntaba nomás eran 3. Yeah. Y ellos me ayudaron bastante. Y como en 2-3 meses yo ya hablaba inglés.
¡Rápido aprendiste!
Es que no tenía opción. Yeah. Es que era o aprender inglés para hacer mis trabajos, entender, hablar con mi maestra, hablar con lo que sea, o literalmente ir a sentarme y hacer nada. Yeah. Y en mi mente yo siempre estuve como que puesta, porque no solo ya había, o sea, cuidado a mi hermano por tanto tiempo cuando mi mamá estuvo acá. Entonces, cuando mi mamá me trajo aquí, era como que, ok, vienes aquí a aprender inglés, vienes aquí a hacer todo bien, vienes aquí a hacer lo que tienes que hacer, y ya. Por eso me gradué a los 15, a los 16.
Y esa es una plática que quiero platicar ahorita en un poquito. Obviamente, nos cuentas de que empezaste a hablar el inglés. Did you ever suffer bullying? You know, vas a una escuela donde no hablan mucho español y luego llegas tú hablando nomás español. Did you suffer bullying? Like, se rían de ti los niños, te hacían bullying, ¿o qué pasó?
En la primera escuela, gracias a Dios, no. En esa escuela siempre era como que de más niños, como que de dinero.
Oh, okay. Ajá. Okay. So it was like a little bougie school.
Ajá.
Okay,
okay. So, entonces realmente a los huercos les valía madre. O sea, si yo hablaba inglés o español, realmente no les importaba.
Yeah.
Pero cuando mi mamá dice, ok, ya no vamos a vivir aquí, nos vamos a otro, porque vivíamos en el Northside, en donde están todos los riquillos.
Los riquillos, ya.
Sí.
Llegaron a lo bueno, amiga. Ajá,
Llegué a lo barrido, no es cierto. Luego, de repente, el año que seguía, mi mamá de que, ok, ahora sí nos vamos para el Westside, yeah. Para los gueros.
Para los gueros, ya no podemos aquí, vámonos para allá.
Para los trenches. Entonces, cuando yo llego ya a Westside de San Antonio, pues fue un cambio, la verdad. Porque ya en esa escuela era como que un poquito con más niños, con más gente, y ahí sí me hicieron bullying. Todos me miraban como que la rara. O sea, de que, oh, esta es rara, habla español, como que. Y luego, para cagarla, en esa escuela me metieron en la clase, se llamaba ESL, Okay, English, yeah, yeah. Spanish language. Me metieron en esa clase y luego como que las otras clases eran puro inglés. Puro inglés. O sea, todos los bilingües en una clase. Todos los mexicanos, pum, juntos.
En una clase, ya.
Y las otras, y las otras clases, no. O sea, todas las otras clases eran como que puro inglés. Yeah, like, yeah. Fancy, like. You know? Entonces, ahí sí, sí me hicieron bullying, la verdad. Me acuerdo que como que yo me trataba de hablarles o ser sus amigos y ellos así como que siempre me hacían hasta que... Ew. Así me hacían los pinches culeros. Me acuerdo, solo me acuerdo de una vez. Es que yo sé que siempre me molestaban porque hubo un incidente en el que yo y un muchacho nos empezamos a decir cosas y el muchacho se hablaba español, yeah, pero como que se sentía muy machito y nos empezamos a decir cosas y me di cuenta que la maestra me castigó a mí. Y yo le dije a la maestra, ¿pero por qué?
O sea, ¿qué hice yo? No escucho lo que él hizo.
Ajá, yo me acuerdo que le dije a la maestra, o sea, literalmente él siempre me molesta a mí y ahora, yeah, que yo le estoy diciendo algo, ¿me vas a castigar a mí? Y la maestra dijo, oh, pero tú dices que te molestan, pero luego vas y tú los molestas a ellos. Y yo así que, güey, me estoy defendiendo, pero a la, yeah, maestra, yeah, le valió. En esa escuela sí hablaban español las maestras.
Did you get in trouble that time thing?
No, no me suspendieron.
Like, pero detention.
No. I got detention once.
In your, yeah, whole life?
Yeah, that was the one time that I got
detention. Shut up.
Yeah, I swear.
So eras niña buena tú en la escuela.
Yo siempre he sido niña buena en la escuela.
Bien estudiosa, a lo que vas. Tú no vas a hacer otras pendejadas, tú vas a estudiar a la escuela.
Yeah.
Which is good, you know what I mean? Yo también llegué aquí a los Estados Unidos súper temprano. Yo pienso que llegué, si me acuerdo bien, empecé el kinder aquí. Eso ha de haber sido como 4 o 5 años. Pero yo aprendí ya bien, bien el idioma. Yo lo quiero decir como para segundo grado. Entonces, my whole elementary years, I had ESL classes. Y me acuerdo that I would always feel like bad for myself. No sé si tú sentiste lo mismo. Like, I would always feel like, ¿por qué me dan esas clases? Which now I understand, obviamente, para ayudarme. Pero yo en ese tiempo, yo me sentía menos que los que hablaban inglés. Did you ever feel that way?
I don't think that was ever my thoughts. But I definitely didn't like the ESL classes. One, because, well, I mean, they did help me, like, perfect my English. Because obviously, like, at first, when I'm telling you, like, I learned English in 3 months, I didn't fully, yeah, learn it. And I feel like to this day, I still don't fully,
like,
know.
Todavía vas aprendiendo, like, yeah, lo aprendiste enough para poder comunicarte.
Yeah, like, I was able to do certain things, but it's not like I could do, like, a whole conversation. Even till, since I graduated, I could never get out of the dumbass fucking ESL classes. It was called... I don't remember what that freaking test is called. It's like a...
What is it called? I know what you mean.
There's like a test.
The state test?
Yeah, but there's like a like ESL thing. And it was like... TELPASS. TELPASS!
I've
fucking
never heard
TELPASS.
Of that. What the hell is that?
Oh my god. Fuck TELPASS. Whoever created TELPASS, hell no. They is a test that you have to take. It's on online. But the thing is that you have to speak. So you have, okay, to write, you have to speak, you have to do questions, answer them, and like editing and doing all these things.
Like to make sure that you know how to speak it good, yeah, in all aspects.
And
yeah,
the thing is that I took that every single year. Like, they, I think you take it twice a year. No, I was taking
pasabas.
It. No, hasta cuando me gradué no lo pude pasar. ¿Puedes creerlo?
So hasta hoy en día todavía no la sigues pasando, amiga.
No,
that's,
and the thing
crazy
is that,
yeah, yeah,
I had already passed all the levels except for the speaking. And I feel like I don't think I have an accent in English, but somehow the people there fucking do. They think I have.
So they were testing you based on your accent or more like, yeah, como lo platicabas?
I think accent, because I think I'm a good speaker sometimes when, yeah, I'm not stuttering.
No, no, I feel like you speak the English language really good.
Not enough.
Apparently
them.
Not enough for that. Yeah, I'm like, apparently not enough for the fucking test, you know? Hablamos un poquito de, you know, la relación con tu papá. ¿Cómo fue la relación con tu mamá? Obviamente te miramos súper cercana a ella. How was that relationship with her? Do you feel like it made up for your dad being absent?
Oh, my mom's my dad. My mom's my dad, honestly. Like, my mom, me and my mom, oh, we're twinning. I don't know, I love her a lot. Mi mamá es... No, es que ni sé cómo explicarlo. Mi mamá es todo para mí. La verdad. No sé cómo explicarlo.
Did she remarry or no?
That's a secret. But yeah, she did.
Did that affect you in any way? Or did you feel like that almost made it better for you in the sense que ahora sí tenías a alguien que podía ser tu padre?
Well, honestly, I really love my stepdad. Yeah. I feel like he has children of his own, of course. Okay. And... Okay, Dad, don't kill me for this. But he's really sweet. He's really sweet. I feel like he takes us as his family, like, yeah, if we were his own. So I love him.
That's something that I feel like not a lot of men get credit for. You know, I always say this. My boyfriend tiene, su mamá se volvió a casar. Obviamente, my boyfriend and my sister-in-law no son hijos de mi suegro, because I call him my suegro, you know what I mean? I always say, like, he is a man, because enabled to take in other people's children, it really is a big responsibility. Y es algo que no muchos take. So it's great que pudo encontrar tu mamá a alguien que no nomás la aceptó a ella, pero también los aceptó a ustedes.
Yeah, he really came in, went for the gallina and the pollitos.
He said, yo me voy a llevar toda esta granja, amiga, literal.
No, literally. I'm dead. I do enjoy him, like having him around. I feel like my little sisters do love him as well. He has experience already being a father, but I don't know, like he just treats us like really good. So I like spending time with him. Honestly, when he's home, I don't know how to explain it. It kind of makes me feel like safer in a way.
¿Cuántos hermanos son ustedes?
Somos cuatro en total. Soy yo, tengo a mi hermano de 13, a mi hermanita de 7 y a mi hermanita de 4.
So your mom ended up having two kids con él.
No, that's the old one.
So she remarried twice then after. Yeah. Okay. Do you feel like you're very close to your other siblings también?
I don't even see that. Honestly, to me, they're my kids, bro. Yeah. At this point, they're not even my siblings anymore. They're my fucking kids. My mom would just be having kids just to hand them on to me. Because, like whenever she used to work, like, a lot, they were just me. Yeah. So, they're my kids, bro. Like, this is why I always say, I don't want kids. I already had three.
Yeah, ya tengo bastantes,
ya tengo tres.
Ya quiero hasta deshacerme de ellos. How was that? Obviamente, nos cuentas un poquito de que, pues, tu mamá, you know, you would take care of a lot of your siblings because your mom was always busy working, you know, trying to provide. Do you feel like ¿cómo te sientes tú tener ese role? You know, obviously you were a sibling too, but going from being, you know, the oldest sister to now almost being like the parent, how was that for you?
Honestly, I'm not going to say it was easy, because obviously those three little demons are not easy to deal with at all. I'm just kidding. No, they're actually really good kids. But I wouldn't change it for the world. Like, I honestly wouldn't change it. I love being with them. Like, I love my siblings. It's, I don't know.
Being there for them so much and being almost like their mom, do you feel like it almost took away from your childhood? Because obviamente tú no estabas muy preocupada in living your life as, you know, a child, but you were more living your life, you know, as, you mentioned it yourself, you had to almost grow up quick and had to be there for them. Did that affect you in any way? Like, where you feel like you missed out on a lot?
100%. I think that being like, how do I explain this? Like, being the mother of your siblings is not an easy role. I don't know how to explain it. Like, it's not something that you could just give out to anyone or have anyone do it perfectly. Because obviously, like, imagine me being a kid and taking care of one, especially when we were, like, in Mexico still, when my dad just didn't give a fuck about us. I feel like that was the most challenging. But I feel like taking care of my first younger brother kind of helped me prepare for the other two.
The other ones.
And honestly, I don't even know. Like, I feel like it did take away from my childhood.
¿En qué manera?
I feel like if I wouldn't have my siblings, I definitely would have had a better childhood. No, that's bad. No, I shouldn't say that. No, I don't know what to say.
I don't think it's bad, but I know what you're trying to say. I feel like you also te montaron una responsabilidad que obviamente para ti en esa edad no era tuya, but you had to como acomplarte and be like, you know what, it is what it is and I have to do this. Yeah. Obviously, sí te quitó mucho de tu infancia, because like you said, you weren't worried about what other people your age were doing. You were more worried about like, ¿cómo están mis hermanos? ¿Están bien? ¿Necesitan algo? I gotta be the mom. So obviously, not that it ruined your childhood, but in a way, it did make your childhood a little different than theirs. Obviamente, ellos vivieron su niñez y la siguen viviendo como niños, but you were living your niñez como mamá. So sí te la cambió. Yeah, it's like real that you say that.
Yeah, but I feel like having them, like I said, kind of made me who I am today.
Yeah.
And I don't know, like, it basically, yeah, it changed me a lot. Like, it made me realize that I don't want kids, first of all, and that, you know, I have to take care of them. I have no choice.
Would they ever fight you back? Like, tú no eres mi mamá, no me digas qué hacer, Meche.
Oh, hell no. If any of my siblings ever told me that, they would get sent to the room, slapped and everything. No food for you tonight or tomorrow.
Hoy no comes, mi amor. You know what's crazy? It's like funny hearing your side and your perspective, because as an older sister, I can't relate porque yo soy el más chiquito. So yo me acuerdo que mi hermano mayor siempre se sentía como mi papá y a mí me molestaba mucho, no sé por qué. Like, I always felt like bro, chill, like, you're not that old. And he was older than me. Él me gana como con 10, 15 años, güey. Like, yo, like, he's all señor, and I'm over here like, you ain't my parent. But it's crazy because, like, as a kid, you know, me being the youngest, yo me acuerdo que yo me peleaba mucho, or I would say a lot of shit, like, you're not my parent, like, you're literally just my brother. And it's crazy que a ti no te ponían eso.
No, never.
Tú bien tranquilitos los hermanitos. They wouldn't talk back.
Honestly, I feel like they were raised really good, like, with manners. They know when to talk or when to not talk. Even, like, my little one, the 4-1 doesn't really know how to talk yet. She's kind of, like, barely in the learning process. The 7-year-old, she will talk to you, like, if she's, like, 15.
You also matured really quickly. You know, obviously, tienes 17 años. But you really don't give off 17 energy. You know, you give off a very mature energy. So I feel like them seeing how you are, pienso que también les puso las pilas de que, no, mi amor, aquí no se van a andar con tonterías. Aquí se van a aplacar y se van a poner bien y me van a hacer caso. Yeah. Did your mom ever, cuando te peleabas con ellos, or when they would go, like, tell your mom, like, Meche hizo esto? Would your mom ever, like, te regañaba o te daba a ti como, like, the, she would be like, no, háganle caso a Meche.
I don't think we've ever had a point like that.
Oh, really? So bien portados eran, entonces.
No, honestly, mis hermanos sí tienen a veces sus berrinches, pero la verdad es que son muy buen portados. Especialmente mi hermano, tiene 13, y él también, siento que he's like so mature at a point that I'm like, damn, like, I'm proud of you. Like, because sometimes he does, like, have, like, moments where he's like, you know, because he's still a kid. But if I'm being honest, he's a really mature person for his age, especially him being 13 years old. He does not act 13. But you're right. He also doesn't because he hangs out with me.
Yeah.
But because my
brother...
Like,
it rubs onto him. Yeah,
yeah. My brother is like, he's kind of like my boy best friend in a way. Because he tells me everything. I tell him everything. Like, we're really close. Same thing with the two little ones, except the little one doesn't know how to talk. But, like...
Pero cuando empiece, te va a empezar a trust you. You know, that's actually really nice que lo comentas así, porque pasa mucho de que, especially because you're almost like a mother figure to them in a sense. Pasa mucho donde muchos niños tienen miedo to even open up to their older siblings because they're going to be like, fuck, they're going to get me in trouble. Le van a decir a mi mamá. So es muy bonito el saber que ellos te tengan esa confianza and that they're like, you know what? Like, that's my sister at the end of the day. She may be like my second mom, but, like, I know my sister's got my back and I can confiarle lo que le quiero confiar porque sé que aunque me regañe me va a guiar towards the right thing to do, you know? Hablamos un poquito obviamente de tu juventud, de tu niñez. Yo quiero hablar del sueño de muchas niñas. Obviamente el sueño de muchas niñas growing up es el tener una quinceañera. Did you have one?
I did. But plot twist, I had my quince when I was 14.
¿Por qué? Wait, cuéntanos. What happened there? ¿Por qué chingados la tuviste un año antes? Sí. ¿Cómo pasó todo eso?
Ok, yo tuve mi quinceañera en julio 17. Ese año iba a cumplir los 15, pero todavía no los cumplía porque yo cumplo en diciembre. Okay. Y me acuerdo que mi mamá dijo, no, pues vamos a hacerla. Faltaba como un mes. Y mi mamá tipo, bueno, pues vamos a hacerla, no sé, X, normal. ¿Para qué esperarnos todo un año? Este año los cumples, como quiera, whatever. Let's do it. So I was like, okay, let's do it. Like, let's plan. And like, she's like, okay, we're gonna do it in a month. And I'm like, okay. I'm like, I have nothing. Like,
how was that? That's intense. In a month?
So intense. So I was supposed to get a choreographer for to do my whole thing.
The baile sorpresa, the vals y todo eso.
Spoiler alert, we didn't get nothing because there was no time. So my mom kind of found like this one salon, and the salon came with DJ, it came with food, it came with cake, it came with
todo light, el paquete.
Con todo el paquete. So mom was like, good deal, I'm gonna take it.
Pero no viene el pinche choreographer. You're like, ¿dónde encuentro uno de esos?
Yeah, so it was basically everything. My mom was like, good deal. Come here, I'm gonna take it. So we booked it. It was like a random date because like July 17th was so random.
Yeah.
And then, we got the dress. It was a red dress. It was super cute. And at the time, I was actually modeling for dresses. Before this whole plan started, I was already modeling for a store over there that sold 15 dresses. So they just gave me one. I still have to pay for it, obviously. But I just got it from there. So I had already modeled like so many colors that I was like red.
Red. Favorito. Like, yeah. You felt like it looked the best on you. Yeah,
I was like red. A lot of people tell me that the blue like dresses that I was trying on were better, but I went for the red. And the choreography. So I used to be in a dance group performing and stuff for like a few years back then before my quince. So whenever my whole quince happened, I already knew that they were gonna try to like ask me for money. So I was like, you know what? I got my cousin, and I got a friend that was also a dancer. It was just me and two other girls. I choreographed it in less than like a week. Both like
vibes. I seen the renegade.
No.
What actually was your quinceañera like surprise dance?
Guepa, reggaeton, guapango.
Un poquito de todo. Did you have damas and chambelanes?
Solo tuve a dos muchachas. No tuve chambelanes para nada.
Panada. How was that?
No, you guys need it.
You're like, bitch, I can do this myself. Yo soy la estrella de la noche.
And I had to make the mix and everything for the whole. I had to do everything because I had literally nothing. All I had was my experience from being in the dance group.
In the dance group. That's crazy. ¿Cómo fue la quinceañera? Like, do you feel like
it was amazing?
It was amazing. ¿Qué fue para ti? Like, now looking back, was there anything that went wrong? Like, now that you look back, you're like, fuck, pasó esto. Like, it fucking ruined it a little bit. Was there anything that happened that you feel like ruined a little bit of the experience?
Okay. So, we all know how I am, which is something I'm trying to change. But for my quince, I literally was late to my own quince.
And are we surprised? Ah, I'm like, no.
Let's act like we're surprised.
That's crazy. I'm like, add shocking effect. Ah, that's crazy. How late were you?
Like... No, not that late, like 30 minutes late. Oh, okay, people were already there and I wasn't even there yet. I was supposed to be the one greeting me, but I wasn't even there.
Where were you?
Getting ready.
So like you weren't even taking pictures or doing all the quinceañera. You were still getting ready.
I was still getting ready because, okay, so when I went to go get my hair and my makeup done, the girl that was actually supposed to do it was late. Oh. It wasn't on me
no
that
era
time.
Mi culpa. Era la culpa de ella.
I know it seems like it's my fault, but it actually wasn't. It was the girl that was doing my makeup. So when I really got there, they were like doing everything, and I actually got a limo. Like, because it came with the package, by the way.
Wow, ese paquete estaba bueno, güey.
So if you guys want to know,
la información. That's good. Like, DJ,
everything.
Mesas, todo.
Todo. Hasta robot traía. Entonces me trajeron un
Those big ass robots? That's crazy. That's cool.
Yeah, it was the craziest quinceañera. But so we got in the limo and the limo was supposed to take us to like different places.
Yeah, yeah.
But they only took me to get my makeup done into the venue. We didn't go anywhere.
Ni al pinche McDonald's vamos a pasar derechito al pinche venue. That's crazy.
We had no time.
Did your mom get mad or was anyone like, ya apúrate, mecha, apúrate?
They were late themselves too, but it was because I was late. So then they had to drop me off and then go get ready. But the thing is that the girls took forever to get there and open. So we were just staying there. So they were also late as hell
too. Ay, Dios. Toda la familia lo heredaste. No, is your mom like a person that gets ready quickly? Because I do see that a lot. Miro muchos TikToks donde la gente siempre anda, ay, no, mecha dura 5 horas. O se andan burlando de ti. Do you actually take that long?
No. Secrets out. No, I'm just kidding. No, I don't. I think it's just because when I'm live, everyone's like talking in the comments and I'm trying to like interact with people and then I'm just blending in and I forget to like continue and I'm just talking to everybody and I'm like this isn't that, or like I start dancing in the middle of nowhere or singing or going live with other people or whatever. So that's what makes me take long. I don't think I've ever taken like 5 hours.
What's like your typical though, like if si te estás concentrando and you're like I need to get ready, what's like your time frame?
Like if I'm going somewhere and I really need to go, I can do my makeup in like 30 minutes.
Y eso sí lo puedo confirmar, porque yo, si ustedes no saben, amigas, Meche actually got ready aquí en mi casa. Yeah. And I remember cuando se metió al baño porque vino Gia y Fátima, hasta les pregunté a ellas, I was like, hey, does she really take 5 hours? Porque yo me arreglo en 1 hora y media. Yo rápido estoy listo. And they're like, oh, no, she can get ready quick. Y cuando te miraba, like, I was literally eyeing you because I was like, okay, let me, because I'm the type of person that I'm like, okay, I need to see what step you're in to see if I can, I feel like my base, I can do it in like 30 minutes. Yeah. Rápido, right? Right? Like, so when I was seeing you do your makeup, I was like, oh shit, ya va bien avanzada la meche. You did get ready super quick.
Yeah.
So you're not a tardy person. You're just, it's just because andas en los en vivos y pues te entretienes.
Sí, la verdad. Es que así soy yo. O sea, si yo puedo estar aquí súper concentrada y de repente, ah, mira una mosca. O sea, no sé, así soy.
Ya empezamos a hablar de la mosca, güey. Así también yo soy. What was like your favorite moment when it came down to your 15th?
I think the whole 15 was really good. Like, for example... nada más les voy a decir esto. Literalmente no tengo ni una foto o ni un video de la quinceañera que yo haya tomado. Porque mi celular no sé ni dónde estaba, la verdad.
Tú en chinga la pista. Baile y baile.
Yo bailé toda la noche, yo bailé con todos, yo comí, yo. Ay, no. que algo que no, no, es que yo hice de todo esa noche.
Platico mucho con like personas de su quinceañera, and a lot of people always tell me, well, not everyone, but a lot of people tell me like, oh, you know, like I didn't really care too much about it, like I had fun, but it almost felt like my mom's quinceañera, because it pasa mucho donde las mamás, you know, they make it about themselves. But the fact that you had fun all night, que ni sabías dónde chingado estaba el teléfono, amiga, means you had a lot of fun.
Oh, I
is so there fun. Anything you would like redo or do differently if you were to go back and like have your quinceañera again?
The only thing I would do is relive it, because it was so lit. It was so lit. And it also wasn't open invite. It wasn't okay, open invite. So only the people that I knew were going. So it was like invitation only. And it was pretty fun. Like it was packed. Honestly, even because I think like 300 people went in like a small ass.
Damn, yeah. Sepa cómo los vamos a caber, pero si vamos
pero
a caber.
Cabemos.
Si cabemos en el cielo, vamos a caber aquí, literal.
Hasta mi maestra fue.
You're like, hasta la directora. Ah,
that's how you
wait, how did you invite her? That's actually kind of iconic. Like, I remember I would try to invite, like, my teachers to, like, little stuff, and they would never go because, obviamente, like, you have to be 18. How was that?
Dude, I literally invited, like, my teacher, my favorite teacher, and she was like, I'll be there. And I was like, are you sure? And she was like, yeah. And then she actually did pull up. I was like, no.
I'm sure in your head, you're like, no, no se va a presentar. Nomás mm-hmm. me dijo eso para que me callara. But the mm-hmm. fact that she actually showed she up went. Shows a lot. She probably te estimaba mucho igual como tú la estimabas a ella. So she's like, no, yo tengo que ir a la quinceañera de la Meche.
Y fue.
Hablamos un poquito de tu escuela, you know, hablamos de high school. How were you in high school? ¿Eras peleonera? ¿Eras the shy girl? ¿Eras popular? Cuéntanos un poquito más de tu experiencia when you were in high school.
So I think I was like, I don't want to say popular, because I wasn't. I was like, how do I explain this? Like, I was just there. I don't know. I was just existing. Because, okay, so I was actually supposed to go to this, like, big, like, public high school. And I was like, yeah, there? Hell no. That's where everyone in my middle school were going. And honestly, I didn't really have a connection with any of them except for, like, two girls that yeah. I still talk to today. One of them was my...
Dama.
Her name is Joanna. Shout out to Joanna. I love you, Joanna, if you see this. And they were all going to the same school. And I was like, hell no. I was like, I can't do this to myself anymore. Like, if I go there, I'm literally doing it to myself. So I went. And actually, I didn't tell my mom about this. Like, I literally told her after I had already done it. I applied to, like, 30 different schools. I was like, hell no, I'm not going to these. And those, you actually had to get accepted. I told my mom, I was like, oh, yeah, I applied to, like, 3 different schools. She was like, girl, I'm not taking you if it's too far. And yeah. I was like, no, it's fine. They're good. They're
you're like, I did my research. We're 15 minutes away.
Yeah, no, actually, I was 15 minutes away.
Oh, damn. Yeah.
So I was like, okay, like, it's fine. It was literally in downtown. So I actually applied to one of those because I was just ready. Like, I was going crazy. And then my second option was the one that I went to. I went to the name is Castech. So Castech, okay. It's like Center of Appliance Science and Technology, something like that. There I had the opportunity to, it wasn't early college, but it was I was able to take UX, which is user experience, cybersecurity, or business.
Oh, shit.
But the first year that you go, they force you to take all of them.
Like, to see which one you like, yeah. To test out the water.
I had already applied to those, and then another good school that was, like, around. I actually got accepted to all of them, but I got accepted into CAS first.
Okay.
So then, because in the other one in the college, they put me in the waiting list. And I was like, these fucking bitches are not going to accept me. And I was like, I'm definitely not going to that ghetto school over there. Hell no. Because, like, literally, that was the type of school that literally had fights every
yeah,
day.
Yeah. Like, you weren't like, about that life. Tú querías ir a estudiar, amiga.
That's how I've always been. Like, I don't like fighting in school or, like, having, like, issues with people. So I was just like, no, I'd rather stay away from that to save my personal self, you know, to save myself and, you know, just be more concentrated and actually getting stuff done. I didn't know that I was going to graduate early at the time, obviously. I had no idea. And I finally get it accepted into all of them, but CAS accepted me first. So I was like, I think this is a sign from God. Like, I think God is telling me this is a school that you need to go to. This is the first school that's opened the doors to you. They didn't say no to you. They didn't put you in the waiting list. They're just letting you come. So just accept it. So I just accepted it, and I got... Like, I got myself, like, mi hermano me inscribió, yo me inscribí. De hecho, también inscribí a mis hermanos.
Y like, a todos nos vamos a esa escuela.
Yeah, chingar su madre. No, sí. Entonces me inscribí y ya, I ended up going. It was cool. I love my high school years. I went for 3 years because I had previously already skipped 1 year.
Okay.
When I got here from Mexico, they did a test on me on like math, reading, and all.
Para ver en dónde quedabas. Uh-huh. Yeah, yeah.
I was supposed to go into third grade. They moved me up to fourth because of how well I aced that test. I had already skipped the grade.
Yeah, yeah.
So I was already below everybody. But then when I was in high school, they gave me the option. They were like, okay, like you can take classes like at night. And graduate 1 year early. I actually could have graduated 2 years early.
Si te ponieras bien, bien
if I would have done
ya.
It, no, because I didn't do it the first year. Because that first year, I was focused on sports. I did swimming and I did archery. They okay. had archery, like random as hell.
Like, bow and arrow? Yeah, what like, the hell? Dude. They're like, ready for the Hunger Games. Están alistando, amiga?
No, actually, I'm really good. I should probably go to Hunger Games. I'm just kidding.
That is crazy. Wait, you actually took the class?
It wasn't a class. It was like a sport. The only class that I had was swimming.
Okay.
Because
okay.
it was either that or pee. And I was like, no, I'd rather like, go
bitch,
swim.
I ain't winning. I'd rather swim, yeah.
Yeah, and we actually won that whole thing. Like, because it was like, after the season was done, there was like a big like fight. Not fight, but like race against all the other schools. We actually took first place number one. Anyways, yeah, so that first year, I feel like if I would have done it, if I would have started taking classes early since that first year, I would have graduated 2 years early or four, 3 years early.
Sorry. So practically, las clases que estabas tomando en la noche were the classes that were for you to like graduate early?
Yeah, they were basically the classes that I was going to take the next year. Mm. So the first year, I didn't do it because I was focused on sports. The second year, that's when I was like, okay, I can graduate early. I'm going to do it. So then I started doing them. It was basically like school from 8:30 to 4, get home. At 5, the classes start.
Oh, rápido, en caliente.
En caliente, órale, estudiar y estudiar. Then it was from 5 to 9. But the thing is that it was like a Zoom call and you had to turn your camera on, of course. And it was like, okay, they would give you like a little like speech or whatever for like a whole hour. And then you had whatever you needed to
like
complete
your work.
That
thing. Yeah, yeah. Yeah.
So I would just finish it like fast and then I would just go to sleep. Honestly, it wasn't that hard. Yeah. Like high school is really not hard. Like, I don't know, just for me, nothing was ever like too complicated because yeah. I've always been the type. And this is why I have such a good relationship with all my teachers. I literally have, like, I could tell you right now, I have, like, at least a good 10 teachers that I still keep in contact with from when I was little.
Yeah, yeah.
Because I'm always, like, talking and, like, asking a lot of questions.
Like, you were there, like, to go to school. Because I feel like a lot of kids nowadays van a ser desmadre. No van a estudiar, güey.
Yeah, no. I knew that when it was me going to school, I knew that I had to do something. And I was going there to do it. I was there learning. So like, and actually I feel like most of the time, like I don't know if this ever happened to anybody, probably not because they're not nerds like me, but like most of the time I feel like the teacher, like everybody in the class wasn't really paying attention. Yeah. So then the teacher would just like focus on me because I was the one listening. So then most of the time they were teaching me,
like it felt personal, you know. Yeah. What's crazy, I had an experience somewhat like that también in high school. Me acuerdo que había una maestra, mi esposada, shout out to her. I've gone hiking with her ya hace nice. Unos años, like I've kept in contact with her too. Well, she reached out and then I was like, oh my god, what is Posada doing here? So long story short, en la escuela se hablaba mucho de que, oh my god, it's so hard to pass her class, like it's so much work, so much this, so much that. And I remember when I got her, because I remember her being like my econ teacher. No me acuerdo, it was like Miss Posada, like economy. Yeah, she was like econ, government. And I got her my second semester. So cuando yo supe que iba a tenerla ella para mi maestra, I was scared, bitch. I was like, oh my fucking god, I've heard she's fucking hard, I'm gonna fucking fail, I'm not gonna graduate. And by this time I was already having a lot of trouble graduating. Como me moví from another school to another school, all my credits got lost. No. So I was already like in the bridge of not graduating. So I was like, fuck, y pa acabarla de cagar, now I'm going with a fucking teacher that everyone says it's hard. No. To pass. Girl, tell me why. I go to the fucking class. The easiest motherfucking class. All you had to do is do your work. And we had like a little notebook donde hacíamos our notes. But our notes, we had to do them ourselves. And they were easy. It's literally just copy the fucking textbook, right? Tell me why she would even let us fucking use a cheat sheet for all her tests. But because no one would do their homework and do their notes at home, pues no está viendo lo que estaban haciendo la test on, and they would fail. Mm-hmm. But whenever they would talk shit on her, I'd be like, y'all are stupid. Ustedes son los burros. Like, it's literally that fucking easy.
No, it literally is.
Did you always like school, or was it something that you were just doing because you're like, fuck, I need to do it?
No, I actually did enjoy my high school years. I really did. Like, my... All three years, I was really happy with my teachers, and, you know, it was fun. It was good.
Te graduaste early. How was that, you know, at 15 graduating? You were a 15-year-old senior. ¿Cómo fue eso, you know, obviamente, your graduation? Did you guys have, like, a big graduation for you? Or?
No, but I have a video. No, I literally, I could you not. For my graduation, I was also late. Let's not say. But I was also late, and I literally got there. Ran inside. They were like, "What school?" I was like, "Cass Tech." They were grabbing the girl from there. She grabbed my arm and she was like, "Let's go!" And we started running inside. I was in heels running, and then everybody was already standing up, like ready to go in and take their fucking thing. I was second lane. I was like, "Fuck!" I ran. I literally run. I'm running everywhere behind people, and I'm like, "Excuse me, excuse me, excuse me." They give me my thing, and I walk out.
Yeah, bien pampante la meche bien sonriendo. That's crazy, juro. Yeah.
Llegué solo para caminar la pinche stage. Y ya, me fui.
Pues está bien. I'm like, bien, vino no de más. Modelo, la mecha. She's like, all those years of modeling the dresses te sirvió en ese tiempo. You know, obviamente te graduaste a los 15 años. Do you feel like...
No, because I was already 16 when 16, I graduated.
16. Yeah. You know, normalmente someone graduates with like 17, 18.
Yeah.
So obviously you skipped out on like 2 years. Do you feel like you missed out on like, you know, prom or all those things that normally uno hace for their high school experience?
Honestly, so my high school, the people there were like to themselves. Because, okay. Like I said, it wasn't like they were like everybody in that school applied because they wanted to go yeah. there, or maybe because their parents forced them. Who knows? But most of them was because they wanted to be
like
there.
They wanted to estudiar. They wanted to go to college. Yeah,
they
yeah,
wanted
yeah.
to be there. You know, so I was surrounded by people that were smart. Now I was surrounded by people that were smart. I literally, could you not? There was only one fight in my whole 3 years. That literally, there was this one fight that was like so random. And then literally, I don't think I've said this before, but literally that fight, it was like two guys. And then this one guy was recording it on a Chromebook.
So not the Chromebook, the school Chromebook?
Yeah, the school Chromebook. So he was recording with the school Chromebook, and then they made an edit out of that. And it was like the two guys that were fighting, some person edited them into making them like they were kissing. So then they started shipping them, the guys that were fighting. They were
salieron beach. Como novios en vez de salir a pleito. That's, did they end up making up because of that or no? Did they hate each other even more because of that little edit?
I don't think so.
You're like, no, terminaron de novios.
No, like they were making so many memes, but it's because like, and it was this whole thing. It became a whole thing in the school, and I was even talking to one of the teachers I still keep in contact with. He was a Spanish teacher. I was like, I was just laughing a carcajadas. Because they were trying to fight, and the fight was so lame that everybody started making memes out of it. Like, if they were together.
Like, it was like, mejor no se peleen. I'm like, hablen, talk it out.
Just like, kiss it out or something.
Like, do something else but fight. Porque no es, la pelea no es para todos. I feel like I would not be a good fighter. Personalmente, like, if anyone would want to fight me, like, yeah, I'm down. Ooh. Depending on the reason, obviously, you know. But I feel like I'd be scared going into it. Yo me acuerdo que in high school, like, there was, like, these people that would want to fight me. And I would be like, okay, like, do something. Pero yo en mi mente, like, I'd be like, yeah, do something. Y yo todo all fucking scared in my mind. I'm like, oh my God, please don't do anything. Like, yo bien caliente aquí con huevos. But, like, I was low-key scared. You know, did anything other than that fight happen in high school that you feel like was, like, the craziest shit you experienced in high school?
Dude, my high school was, like, lame. It was lame, but in a good way. Because after they were getting shipped, like, I feel like everyone after that was so scared to fight, even like girls with girls, like they were just scared to fight because like, then no. They would be shipped to be together.
Like, no, se van a reír de nosotros en vez.
Literalmente.
You know, you're in high school, and during this time, empiezas a hacer las redes sociales. You know, you start doing social media. Ahorita te vemos all over everyone's For You page with more than 1.4 million followers on your main TikTok account. ¿Cómo empezó todo eso? Yo quiero saber, how did you say one day, like, you know what? Voy a empezar a hacer videos. Voy a empezar a hacer en vivo. Porque eso es lo que yo quiero hacer. ¿Cómo empezó Mecha en social media?
Pues yo, si te soy sincera, te puedo enseñar un video de cuando yo estaba chiquitita grabando. O sea, yo literalmente hasta tengo un video en YouTube que se llama como Justin Bieber, te amo. Nunca me contestó, por cierto. No, no es cierto. No, pero en serio. O sea, yo siempre he sido de que grabarme y hacer TikTok. Mi mamá, cuando ella se vino para acá, para los Estados Unidos, ella me compró un celular. Entonces yo tenía 6 años teniendo Facebook, teniendo Musical.ly, teniendo Instagram, teniendo todo. De todo, literal. Entonces yo siempre era como que tomarme fotos y de grabarme. Yo empecé a hacer en vivos, de hecho, el último año antes de graduarme.
Okay.
Yo empecé a hacer en vivos arreglándome todas las mañanas. Era, a veces tenía como 10 personas, a veces 20. Un día, de hecho, este día, ay, es que no voy a decir nombres, pero cuenta que yo tenía un novio, bueno, por ahí. Un día él y yo dijimos, ok, ya, hasta aquí, eso se acabó, nunca más, ya, X, bye. Y yo estaba muy triste. Entonces, ese fue el primer día que yo hice un en vivo para distraerme en la tarde. Okay. Yo nunca había sido un en vivo en
You're
la tarde.
You're more in the morning.
Ajá,
yeah.
Era nada más de que, me voy a arreglar para tener con quién hablar, porque no hay con quién
hablar. Like, matando dos pájaros con un tiro. Me arreglo y me voy en vivo.
Ese día hice un en vivo en la noche y yo estaba de que triste, ahí platicando, ahí diciendo todo el chisme como siempre. Y me acuerdo que me llegó una invitación de un muchacho.
Okay.
Y yo así de que, ok, pues sí, estoy soltera, soltera season. Entonces le acepté, lo que sea. Nos hicimos amigos y luego después, el día siguiente, él me agrega a un en vivo con...
¿Con una persona?
Con una persona que es cantante, que es famosa. Después de ahí empezamos a hacer en vivos, yo y esta persona y este cantante. Pues así, empezamos a hacer en vivos. Gracias a esta persona empecé a crecer. Después... llega todo momento, toda una era de que llega de que me eche con novio por fin. Y ahí fue cuando ya empecé a crecer. Y después dejé al novio, le dije thank you, next. Y pues así empecé a crecer sola. Seguía haciendo los en vivo, seguía haciendo todos los días. Luego conocí a lo que es Lalo. Y él, yo y otro muchacho que se llama Allen. Y hacemos en vivos toda la noche, desde las 2 de la mañana hasta las 10 de la mañana. Ajá.
That long?
Ajá. A veces hasta me quedaba más tiempo.
¿O te quedabas dormida en el en vivo?
Una vez, sí, de hecho tengo un video en el que Lalo me está diciendo cosas de que Meche, wake up, Meche.
And you're knocked out, toda like dormida. Estaba roncando la Meche.
No, I wasn't snoring, thankfully, but I was like this.
Con la boca abierta, casi se te metía la mosca, güey.
Yeah, literally, I was sleeping. That was the first time I fell asleep on the live. But yeah, no, it was only just me and us three, like, doing TikToks. I'm still very cool with them.
Empiezas a hacer estos videos, estos en vivos. You start, you know, getting a following. ¿Cómo se da cuenta tu mamá que tú estás haciendo las redes sociales?
I don't think my mom really cares, to be honest. No, I think the first time that she finally realized was, oh, okay, so at first when I started making, like, lives, you know, you gain money from those. So I think the first time that she was like, okay, was when I asked her, I was like, hey, mom, can I go get my nails done? And she was like, no, no tengo dinero. And I was like, well, I kind of made like $100 on doing lives. Like, I've been doing it for a few days now and I was able to save $100. Like, you know, can I use them? And she was like, yeah, of course, it's your money. Yeah. So from there on, I was like, damn, I got my own nails for that worked for it. I mean, I guess you could say I worked for it because I was there. I that was not my first job, obviously.
¿En qué trabajaste?
Well, I started working when I was like, when I first got here.
Okay.
Like, me and my mom, we would sell cakes, but like, I would go to the people. Like, we would, like, I don't know if you ever seen like, those, like, people that go into restaurants and they have like their baskets and they go,
oh yeah, yes, with gelatinas and like all those stuff.
That was me in 2015. So if you ever got bothered by a little girl in 2015 in San Antonio, that was me.
You're like, and I'm sorry.
I'm not sorry. But I do appreciate everyone who brought something for me because, yeah, y'all the real ones. No, I'm just kidding. So I started doing that and then we kind of stopped for a little bit. Later on, when we were more financially stable, later on, I got a job at a mall. I worked at the mall.
How was working at the mall?
I worked like 3 different jobs in the mall because like first I was doing skin, like selling skincare in like a kiosk. And then I got a better job offer right next door, which was like a bracelet. So then there were bracelets. I was selling like bracelets, like ojo bracelets and like chains and rings and everything that you could think of, but me selling it. And they even had like shoes and everything. But then it got bad because sometimes, like, since it was only me, because in a kiosk, there usually should be like multiple people. Yeah. But the guy, he was so greedy. He didn't want to pay me. He had cameras though. So he would just leave me there. I would go in, open everything by myself. He wasn't even there. Like, it was just, I was just literally his servant doing everything. And he was paying me good though. He was like paying me like $11. Because the other job was paying me $7 an hour. This one was paying me $11. So I was like, ooh.
You're like, bitch, almost double.
Literally. I was like, yeah, that's pretty. My stomach is growling. I'm hungry. Okay. So I was like, that's amazing, you know? But the downfall was that sometimes people would see that it was only me there. And sometimes they would go, like, walk past and, like, sneak a ring or
two. Te robaban.
Or, ajá, me robaban los culeros. Y ya cuando, pues, cuando ya me daba cuenta o cuando él se daba cuenta checando las cámaras, no, pues, ya estaban en sus putas casas enjoying the new ring.
No, estrenándole on fucking Instagram. Did you get in trouble?
Yeah, they would take the, whatever money was stolen, they would take it out of my paycheck. So I was like, fuck this. Like, I'm not doing this. Like, first of all, like, I am, what, like, I was 15, no, I was 16. Yeah, I was 16 at the time. I was like, bro, I'm 16. I can't, I'm barely even figuring out how to work right for you. Like, trying to do everything. Because then, not only that, but I had to restock. Because you know how it was on shelf?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So every time someone took one or another, like, I had to go get it from the big thing, go try to find it because everything had numbers, go find it, put it back in. And sometimes people would take, like, 10, so I would have to restock, and then there's another person. Oh, my God, it was so much.
Era un desmadre.
Era un desmadre, literal.
You start doing social media, y empiezas a ganar tu dinerito, and you're like, wait, like, no tengo que trabajar en el mall, puedo estar aquí en casita. ¿Cómo fue eso para ti, el saber que, you know, you can make money on social media? Did you have a moment where you realized that you can make social media like your full-time job?
I don't know. I don't think I've had that moment yet. Me looking for a side job, right? No, I'm just kidding. No, I don't know. I think I'm just kind of like surviving, you know? Like, oh, like if I don't know. I'm just surviving, man. I'm just trying to live day by day and trying to... Whatever money I make obviously doesn't go to me. Yeah. Whatever money I make is for my family, for bills, for taxes, for whatever it is, for whatever, you know, groceries. So I don't know. It's just like everything I make is just for them, yeah. Not for me.
How does that make you feel? Obviamente, you know, knowing your story, knowing how much your mom busted her ass off, and now at 17, poder tú ayudarle a ella. ¿Cómo te hace sentir eso? Like, does that make you feel like, wow, like I'm doing something at my temprana edad?
Honestly, if I'm really honest, not really. I kind of just see it as something that I have to do. Because if I don't, then who will? And who's going to feed these kids? Me. Me and my mom. So it's just like, I don't know. It just things that it comes off naturally. Like, I have to do it. There's no other choice.
So when you get paid, you're like, mom, toma. Toma mi cheque.
Ah. First of all, all of my whatever checks, they're linked to her account. So they don't even, I don't even know. They
just ni llegan a ti. Nomás llegan a la cuenta bancaria, amiga.
Nomás llegan a ella. And I have the card, but I don't have it with me. So, like, but I do have it on my phone, though. So if I ever do just want to, like, pay something or, like, buy something, then I'll take it out of there. But it's usually never like that.
Obviamente, te vemos all over social media. And during these past couple of years that you've been doing social media, te hemos visto también en muchos escándalos. Y en esos escándalos, you get exposed to a lot of hate. ¿Cómo right. le has hecho tú being so young and being so exposed to all this hate? How do you deal with it? ¿Te ha afectado a ti?
Yeah, many times, actually. Many, many times. Honestly, I feel like people don't realize that what they say hurts. Yeah. Especially me, that like, well, first of all, I'm sensitive. I'm just sensitive. Like, if someone screams at me, that's it. That's all I need for me to cry. So, like, for example, like, when people say things, and I try to be active with my people, so I try to go and read every comment, like every comment, reply to comments and stuff, and sometimes I do read the hate comments, and I'm like, damn, like, do they really think of me like that? And some, I feel like even sometimes they make like, como que me ponen ideas en la cabeza. Like,
cosas que tú ni estabas pensando.
Sometimes they make me see things that I'm like, wait, am I looking the problem? Like, sometimes, like, I think I've treated myself like maybe I should treat myself better in some parts, because I'm like in that specific moment, they made me feel like, oh my God, like everything's my fucking fault. Like, I can't believe that I did that. Or like, how do I fix this? And then now I'm like, the hell, what were you thinking? Like, you were not in the wrong.
Yeah.
Like, I was really not in the wrong. But sometimes I feel like some people are really vulnerable to the comments. Like me, I feel like I'm really vulnerable. Like the comments hating, and I go cry or something.
And I feel like it's very easy for it to get to you, because like you said, you're a very interactive person. So obviamente tú quieres interactuar con todos tus seguidoras. You want to make sure that they feel listened to, that you're talking to them. So obviamente cuando you're going through the comments, you're seeing all this hateful shit and you're like, wait, you know, like, what the fuck? Do you feel like because of everything you've gone through, do you feel like that hecho más como private in a lot of senses, like where you don't feel like you want to share too much because you already know como la gente?
100%. I understand. Like, I feel like once you put something out there, it's like you cannot, you don't have like the opinion, you're going to get an opinion back. If they know something, they're van a opinar.
Yeah.
Why? Because they know and they feel entitled to your life. So that's why me, like after that whole situation happened, I feel like I've stayed pretty private. Still, there's still some things that, you know, like end up popping out because I make mistakes or whatever. But like, I feel like my life has been more private than before, 100%. Because people don't know what I'm doing. They don't know anything. Because I also don't go live anymore. Like, and that's something I got to fix. I will go live more often, I promise. But I kind of like stopped doing all that. So it's kind of like people don't really get to interact with me. And the thing is that like when I do go live, everything comes back up. Like someone screen records something and then the comments are hating and I'm just like, oh my God, like this is why I move away from social media sometimes.
Has it ever gotten so bad, the hate, where you feel like you've gotten to a dark moment in your life where you felt like ya no puedes más con esto?
100%. Especially when I had just started. Because when I had just started, yeah, before anybody, like, this was their first time seeing me with someone, and this was the first time where, like, a lot of eyes were on me, and I guess the people were just biased against me, so everyone, I don't know who started it, someone started, but they started calling me Squidward because of my nose, so they started calling me Squidward, and those, like, it was literally so bad that, like, all of my comments were just Squidward, everyone, and, like, they would just make videos, and they would comment on my own videos, they would, on my Instagram, DM me, like, it was just so much, and then I think I talked about it once in live, and I think I was crying, like, I was like, bro, like, I can't believe that people are just so mean, and then most of the comments were like, well, if you don't like it, then log out then, or, like, don't be live then, you're the one putting yourself here, and then I was like, bro, y'all are right, like, I'm literally doing this to myself, like, but then I just couldn't understand, like, yes, like, I am kind of doing this to myself, but just because I'm on here doesn't mean that you get to bully the hell out of me just because I'm here. Like, and especially because even in high school, like, I never really had that problem of bullying. Why? Because everyone was just so centered in themselves. I never really had that problem, especially me, like, not having a lot of friends in high school, like, not getting that many, like, opiniones from going to, like, getting a lot of opiniones from people and especially them being ruthless with me. I feel like that hurt a lot. That hurt. I'm not gonna lie.
During that time, did you stop doing content because of the comments?
Hell no. Hell no. I never stopped, but I surely wanted to. But I don't know. I feel like I've always been, like, really, ¿cómo se dice? Como que, like, someone that perseveres a lot. This is actually why at first, like, I didn't want to share too much about my life. I didn't want to explain, like, my age, of course. I didn't want to say it because I didn't want people on the internet to see me vulnerable. I don't think they've ever seen me vulnerable. Just that one time where I was like, damn, like, why are y'all mean? But from there, I don't think they've ever seen me, like, vulnerable or crying or anything like that. And it was because I was not trying to put that out there. Like, I didn't want people to feel like, oh my God, like, poor Meche. Like, she went through this whole thing with her family. Like, she went through this and that. I didn't want them to think about me like that. I want them to think of me and see me and be like, damn, that's fucking Meche, the fucking girl that sings Dime Cuando, you know?
Dime Cuando.
Fire at the cuarto. Something like that. You know? Like, I wanted them to think of me, like, as an artist.
Yeah.
I didn't want them to be like, oh, poor Meche. But then that whole situation when that thing happened last year, then I was forced to, like, speak out. Yeah. I was forced to, like, be vulnerable on the internet. It was my first time being vulnerable. And I even, when I had the podcast with Jenica, I told Jenica, like, I don't want to be vulnerable. Like, I didn't want to show my emotions because then I feel like people were even more ready to belittle me.
Was it scary to get to that point that you're like, you know what, I'm gonna have to be vulnerable because, you know, how things are laying out? Is it hard for you whenever you do get on social media? Not just with that situation, but anytime you do have to get vulnerable, is it hard for you?
Not anymore, but that first time, I was like, damn, I mean, actually, no. I think it could get hard sometimes. But now that I have more experience with, like, talking and going live and talking to people, meeting people in person now and everything, it's easier. It's easier to be vulnerable. And I feel like from last year, I've learned a lot. Like, I've learned that it's okay to be vulnerable. Because obviously not everyone has good days. Not everyone. Sometimes, you know, I go through it too. And it's just emotions.
Life isn't perfect. Gina, nos cuentas un poquito de que cuando te estaban atacando over your nose, mucha gente, you know, te comentaban hasta cosas peores. And I feel like that's a thing that we see a lot on social media. Miran a influencers, miran hasta cantantes, and people are like, oh, this is what you guys signed up for. No, mi amor. We signed up to entertain y'all. We signed up to do video positive stuff. We did not sign up para que nos tiren un chingo de mierda, you know what I mean? Because, and I feel like people love to hide behind that, like, you signed up for this, ahora aguántate, and it's like, no, what do you mean someone signed up to get hate? Exactly. No, that just means you're a hating ass bitch, you're a bitter ass person, that you feel like you have to project all of that onto someone else, y se les hace muy fácil hacerlo on someone that they don't know on social media.
Exactly, like for example, when they were telling me, like, log out, then I was like, yeah, like, I kind of realized, like, yes, they're kind of, I'm kind of doing it to myself. But then again, like, why does it need to be like this? Yeah. Like, why can't I just be here and, like, not be loved, but, like, at least not be hated, like, the way I was? So I just persevered a lot. Like, I persevered. I kept going. I literally pushed through the fucking hate. Because it was so much. It would just keep coming. Even if I wasn't doing nothing, it was just, like, a video of me doing whatever. Then, the people kind of, like, it kind of started changing.
Yeah.
It kind of, like, there was so much hate, and then it turned into love, which I'm so grateful for. I love all my girls.
I want to talk a little bit more about the hate, en el sentido de que miro también en tus comentarios que a lot of the hate comes from grown-ass women. You know what I mean? Like, yeah, you'll get hate from people your age, but a lot of them can be, like, women que tienen hijos, que I'm like, wey, vete a pinche darle de comer a tu bebé, que estás haciendo acá tirándole mierda a Mecha. How does it make you feel when you see people twice, three times your age talking shit on you?
Pues, la verdad, I'm not really, like, a person to, like, argue back with comments. But when it's, like, someone like that, it's just, like an older person, someone that's older than me, I can't really reply, first of all, because they're older, so I gotta respect people. But I don't know. For me, it's just, like, they're just so miserable with their lives that they gotta come hate on mine. And it's just, whatever. Like, at the end of the day, they're just commenting behind a screen.
Yeah.
I'm giving them entertainment. Like, first of all, you should be happy that I'm here because I'm entertaining you. And I'm not that funny, so that's a big deal.
But that is very true, though. I feel like a lot of the, like, that's how I see my socials. I see my socials as, like, I'm entertaining you. You know what I mean? And when I have seen comments about, from grown-ass women, you know, coming at you or talking shit to you, si me hace pensar en la manera de que, wey, like, no has de tener nada más importante en tu vida going on that you're over here worried about a 17-year-old girl. Like, tanto te está calando lo que está haciendo la Meche that you literally have to go on your phone and, like, type out these big-ass paragraphs. Because a lot of the time, I don't know if you get them too, but a lot of the times when I get hate, I mean, when I used to get hate back in the day, I feel like now I'm almost fucking 30, so yo puedo ser esas personas ahora. But when I was younger and doing social media and I would get hate from older people, I would always be like, bro, like, I'm literally living my life. Like, usted ya vivió la tuya. It literally is like that because it doesn't ever affect you. You just kind of se te resbala.
I feel like now, the comments, even though sometimes they do still get to me, because I'm not going to say that they don't get to me anymore. They still get to me sometimes. But then when I think about it, like, when I start actually, like, analyzing what they're telling me, because they're literally telling me, you know, they're commenting on my page. So, like, it's like a message for me. So I started analyzing it, and I'm like, bro, like, I'm literally just here. Like, the reason why I'm here is to provide for my family, to entertain you, and to survive. I don't know. I'm just existing. Like, so, like, when people just, like, when, especially when grown people, like, hate on me, it's just, like, I don't get it. I really don't understand it.
¿Qué haces tú ahora? You know, obviously, it used to get to you. What are you doing now differently that you feel like has worked a lot with, like, your mental peace, your mental health when it comes to hate comments?
So I'm not gonna lie. Sometimes I block people. Because I'm like, you are over here saying all this. Like, you're not going to come bug me on my cellular device. You're not going to come bug me on a phone that I pay for. blocked.
Y soporta.
Y soporta.
Y luego andan chingando. ¿Por qué me bloqueó? Porque andabas ahí de metiche hablando tu pinche mierda. I hate when people are like, especially, you know, me. It happens a lot too. I'll get a lot of, especially when I do the podcast and I reveal my guest. I'll get like those people that like obviously have gotten blocked by my guest. And they'll be like, I don't know why I'm blocked. I'm like, sí sabes, mi amor. Has de haber dicho algo que no le gustó a la persona y por eso te bloquearon. So no andes aquí haciéndote pasar como que no haces nada. Ajá, you know what I mean?
De santo nada tienes.
When it comes to hate online, I feel like a mí ya se me resbala. There was a long time and a long period donde sí me afectaba and I would be like, oh my God, they think this or they think that. But I think now I've gotten to a place in my life where I'm like, una, las personas no saben lo que en verdad goes behind the scenes. And two, these people are probably living miserable lives que a huevo quieren que uno lo acompañe. You know what I mean? Like, misery loves company. Y pues, mi amor, no te voy a acompañar. Quédate ahí solo. Sufre tú. Hablamos un poquito del hate, pero yo quiero hablar del amor. ¡Ah! He mirado mucho en tus comentarios, cuando miro los en vivos. ¿Cómo le va Meche en el amor?
Quieta con eso. Quieta. Me va horrible. Me va horrible. A mí, no, no sé. Yo siento que estoy como que embrujada o algo, porque es que a mí no me va bien. No me va bien el amor.
¿En qué sentido? Like, ¿sientes que las personas que escoges no son las personas adecuadas? ¿Por qué sientes tú que no te va bien?
Bueno, pues yo tuve una relación, ¿verdad? Y duramos 2 años. Y al final, bueno, este muchacho fue como que mi primer amor y fue muy importante para mí. Nuestras familias se conocían. Era, it was a big deal. Like, yeah. He was, like, to me, I was marrying that man. That was my first relationship. I was like, my man, screaming it out. Like, that boy was mine.
Yeah.
Then everything was so good. Like, we had such a loving relationship. It was amazing. And then towards the end, it started getting, like, really toxic. Like, crazy toxic. And then he asked me for, like, he basically said he wanted to, like, break up, but not really break up. So like going like a break. Yeah, he wanted
but
to
still be exclusive.
Yeah. 2 weeks later, I found out that this man actually had a whole girl behind the back, and that's what he wanted, a break.
This whole time you guys were dating?
No.
Oh, okay.
Like
okay.
He had just met her.
Okay.
But
okay.
They were nothing yet. But then whenever he asked me for the break, then that's when they started like going out and dating. And the thing is that this girl somehow had my number. So I don't know if he gave it to her or something, but like one day out of nowhere, the girl texted me and she sent me like a bunch of videos of them being together. And I was like, all right, I was like, damn, okay. So it's like that. Okay.
¿Cómo sentiste tú en ese momento? Obviamente pensabas que este iba a ser tu marido.
Yeah.
Y te estás dando cuenta que pues no es tuyo.
No, and you want to know what's worse? That this girl was opposite of me in every single way. Like, for example, me, like, I don't really like I wear cute clothes, but like not to the point where I'm like showing everything. Like, yeah. I think I only have like one picture with bikini and that's it. Like, I don't, you know, I'm not really like a showing body type person, not that much. Maybe like wearing fajas and, you know. And she was like someone that would dress like that, and she would post it, like posting like pictures like arching or like doing all these things, and like he would never even let me post like certain stuff because it was too much for social media to see. Yet he was fucking with this girl that was showing everything, doing this, smoking everything, like doing all the crazy shit that I would have never done because I was the good girl dating him, the girl that was supposed to be the mother of his kids, you know. And like I had la verdad sí tenía bastante ilusión con él. Like, yeah, fuck, I loved him. Like, I can say that I loved him, like, so much. Even though I had already had, like not relationships, but, like, talking stages with other people. But he was just...
Era otro. Do you feel like, obviamente, as a girl, you know, suele pasar mucho que cuando they get cheated on or they get left for someone else, sienten como que les pega mucho el... They get too focused on the, like, the girl they cheated with or the girl they left them with. Y a veces le puede afectar uno, like, oh, I'm not good enough or they're better than me. Did that ever happen to you? Like, ¿te sentiste menos or did you not feel enough for him when you found out who he was dating?
Honestly, yeah, because especially, like, I'm telling you, she was everything I was in. Like, for example, me, like, back then, I was more on, like, the skinny side. Right now, I feel like I'm a little bit more, like, thick and, like, I don't know. But back then, I was, like, really skinny. Like, even, like, if you look at videos from me, like, a years ago, like, my face was so skinny. Yeah. Like, como que se me veía todo así los huesos. And right now, I'm not like that anymore. I'm more like
You look chubby. Good, though. You look good. No, like you look good.
I'm like a bear right now. No, but so back then, I was a little bit more on skinny side. She was more of a thick, like, thick thighs, big ass, and whatever. She had, like, everything. And she was black. So she had, like, she wasn't black. No, she was black. She was, like, black mixed with, like, something. I don't remember.
She was mixed. Yeah, yeah. Yeah, yeah.
And then she had, like, edges and all that. And she would wear, like, craziest outfits. Well, I was there being the Santita. Complete opposite of her. Complete opposite. Working, by the way, doing all these things. And she was just everything I wasn't.
Did you ever confront him? Like, cuando te dices cuenta lo que va a pasar. ¿Qué pasó ahí? Cuenta eso, amiga.
Dude, he... Oh, and to make... Okay, so... He literally... No, es que era un perro. Literalmente era un perro maldito. No, maldito sea el día que lo conocí, la verdad. So there was this one time where he cheated on me. He was with her and then he came to my house. Right? So he goes and does whatever he had to do with her. The business. And then he came with me to hang out and watch a movie. So we were just there just watching a movie. And then... Because we weren't, I don't know, I don't want to say too much. I don't want to, like, over-explain too much. But, like, it was just, like, we didn't do nothing. Like, it was just me and him hanging out. And then I guess he, like, left and whatever. I never found out that he was with her until later on. And when I confronted him about it, he was like, bro, I literally went and I fucked another bitch. And then I went and I kissed you. You think someone that loves you would have done that to you? I was like,
oh my god, tu corazoncito, yeah, amiga. I was like, what the hell?
I was like, I can't believe you just said that. Like, yeah, of course. Like, someone that doesn't love me is not gonna. Someone that loves me is not gonna do that. So that's when I realized that he literally just told me to my fucking face that he does not.
And he never loved you.
Yeah.
That's crazy. ¿Qué pasó en ese momento? How did you feel?
I feel like someone stabbed me. Like.
Era de humillarme, no matarme.
Literal. Era de humillarme, no matarme. Like, I'm like. Really? Really, babe? Is that how it is? So, after that, like, something switched inside me. Like, that day, I still remember it. And I don't remember much. Like, yeah. I have this thing, like, where my memory blocks out.
Trauma block. Yeah.
Yes, I have that. So, most of my childhood, I don't remember. I only remember specific or really traumatic stuff. Yeah. I don't remember much. Same thing with that relationship. Like, I swear to God to you that we were dating for 2 years. I don't remember a thing. I don't remember where we went, what we used to talk about. I don't remember none of it.
Was it like a toxic relationship?
Yeah, it was toxic. It was hella toxic.
Obviamente, estando en la relación, do you remember the moment where you realized that the relationship had turned toxic? Or maybe like a moment where like you realized now, maybe, yeah, looking back where you're like, fuck, that was a red flag and I ignored it.
I think... Okay, so me and him had a relationship where, this is so toxic, dude. Like, where we had each other's passwords on Instagram. Okay. We had each other's phones, phone passwords. So we could check each other's phones all the time. We had each other's, like, Facebooks accounts. Like, we share everything. Like, even, like, Snapchat and, like, things that you didn't even need to share. Location.
Cuentas bancarias.
No. But we did have, like, locations and all that things. There was just one time where we got into a big fight. Because at the end, like, we were just arguing a lot. And I think one of the times, like, he was just like, okay, like, we just stopped talking. And he didn't want to give me his accounts no more.
Ya andaba de puto.
Desde ahí, no, nunca me las volvió a dar. Y también apagaba su ubicación. So then there was this one day where I was, like, literally going insane. Like, give me your account. Like, I need your account. Like, give me your Instagram
frustrada
password.
La
like, why did you lock me out? Like, why did you lock me out? Like, oh, you're, like, going, like, why?
Estás estresada en el corner. Volviéndote loca, amiga.
No, yeah. Like, tirándome los pelos, like, toda maniaca, toda loca. No, never again. Hell no. So, that's when I realized, I was like, damn, like, I'm kind of crazy. Like, that's not okay. Yeah. Like, that's not normal.
Like, behavior. You checked yourself. You're like, bitch, like, you shouldn't be doing this, like, much for a guy.
Why am I tripping over an account? Like, it's just an account. Like, no, I was tripping bad.
But I feel like it also maybe stemmed from, like, everything you were already living with him. Obviamente, ya notabas que la relación era tóxica. So, like, you only were going crazy because whatever he was doing was making you think that
exactly.
way and react that
he,
way.
He literally made me crazy. And I could you not, like, after... Oh, because then, after that, he after he didn't want to give me his passwords, he was telling me like, no, like, it's because we need to trust each other. Like, see, like no confías en me, and you think I'm going to go do this and that. Okay. So then that's when I was like, okay, you're right. And then we were like, okay, like, we need a break. Like, this is where he asked, like, for a break. Like, you're too crazy. Like, look what you're doing over an account. Like, you're crazy. Like, you
making you, you know? Feel the, like the yeah, crazy girl.
Like,
yeah.
And I'm just like, you're right. I'm crazy. Like, you got me there. Because, like, no, he was literally humbling me down. Like, that man knew how to, like, humble me. He knew what to tell me to, you know, to hurt me.
Pero pasa mucho también, like, a lot of men that are like that, like, they know they're doing shit behind your back. And then when it comes to you, like, approaching them, or when it comes to you confronting them, te voltean la tortilla, amiga. Mm-hmm. Like, they're like, no, es porque, mira cómo actúas. And I'm like, mi amor, estoy actuando así porque me estás dando la pinche razón. Literal. Like, you're giving me a reason. It's crazy, you know, obviamente hablamos de esa relación. Did he ever, obviously, cuando you confronted him y te dijo lo del que una persona que no te ama would never do that to you, did you guys ever talk again afterwards? Or, like, after that, you were like, no. Aquí, I'm gonna love myself more. I'm done with you.
First, that's when he gave me, when he didn't want to give me those accounts, that's when he asked for the break. After the break, that's when we had that talk where he was like, because in the break, he was with that other girl.
Yeah.
And obviously that was no break. That was breakup. At this point, like, no, yeah, yeah. He broke. I'm up. No, I'm just kidding. Okay, so.
I just got that. I literally just processed that. I was like, wait, what? Me? Yes.
No, literally. He broke. I'm up. No, but. Okay, so. So we, whatever. He ends up going with that other girl. And I leave him. And then, I'm sorry, but I went back after he told me that. No, but okay.
¿Qué te dijo? ¿Qué te hizo que te regresaras con él?
So, I don't know. Honestly, I was just stupid. But the thing is, like, honestly, I was super naive. I feel like at that point, I felt like I was just, like, it's because he would also say really hurtful stuff. So, like, he would tell me, like, no one's going to love you like this ever again. Or, like, manipulating me and me getting manipulated, like, a little, like, yeah, monito. Like, I'm just doing whatever he said.
Te hacía sentir como que si él era lo mejor que te puede pasar a ti en tu vida.
He was, like, he made me think that I would never find nobody else to love me. Which he was wrong, because his homies did love me. Hey!
You're like, they were in my DMs right after.
No,
babes.
They literally were. No, they actually.
How embarrassing, huh? No, say
it. I don't care. They can know they were. And there still are in my DMs. Let's not say. But, no, I'm just kidding. I'm not kidding. But, no, okay. So then I take him back, because I'm, like, naive. And there was this one time where we were laying down with each other, and he was hugging me, and I was looking at the ceiling, and I know he knows that this was that was gonna be the last time we seen each other.
Like your breaking point, yeah.
Yeah, even though we were together, like at this point, like I was just looking to the ceiling, and I was like, why am I here? Like, why does he get to touch me? Like after everything, like after because I seen like videos of like them doing things and stuff. So I was like, why am I gonna take him back after he's literally been with another woman? Yeah. Like he literally touched another woman. Like why would I want him? So I was just thinking about him and like about thinking about the whole situation. I was just like, no, I can't do it. I was like, I literally can't. And that's the day. So that was the day that I actually wrote Demoniática. So in that song I say, que toque mi piel ya no es lo mismo. Todos me dicen que eso es egoísmo. Me ven una vez y quieren repetir. A mi manera nadie puede resistir. And then I say something. Like, I just keep going. It's just me talking about, like, the whole
situation.
Like,
the relationship, what you learned about it, yeah.
Because I was like, damn, because I think whenever he was, like, hugging me, I was like, I didn't want to hug him back. And he just called me egoísta. So egoísta in English is selfish.
Yeah.
So that's why I said, todos me dicen. No, he called me selfish. Sorry, I mixed it up. He called me selfish. And selfish in Spanish is egoísta.
Egoísta, yeah, yeah.
So then I was like, que toque mi piel ya no es lo mismo. Todos me dicen que eso es egoísmo. But it's not. Like, it was just literally, it happened. Yeah.
I think it was more too in ese momento, tú obviamente, after living everything you lived with him and after going through everything that he put you through, I think llegaste a un momento donde dijiste, sabes que me voy a querer yo más a mí misma, me voy a valorar, and I don't need this fucking guy que me está haciendo todas estas cosas to be here. Like, literally, like, you are a prize, you are, you know, a trophy, and the fact que el pendejo andaba con este, contigo a la misma vez y él se la chingaba de bien hombre, like, you had a realization where it's like, no, mi amor, like, aquí terminó todo esto. How was it when you guys finished it? Like, ¿no lo podía tolerar?
Honestly, no. To this day, he still can't forgive me. Sorry. Sorry.
But it's true.
No, it's true. So, la verdad duele. No necesito. So, whenever I left that relationship, and the reason why I came back to that relationship in the first place is because I didn't leave until I was mentally checked out of the relationship. Like, I literally stayed every single time until I didn't cry no more. Yeah. Like, it was like he was leaving. I was like, okay, I don't give a fuck. Like, you always come back anyways. And he did. Like, there was a point where I was like, I realized that he was going to come back. Whatever I did, he was going to come back. And he did. Like, so I wasn't even crying anymore. It didn't even hurt me no more. But the thing that had changed was the fact that he, like, had already done so much. So I was like, I'm not going to go back to you. Yeah. Like, even if I tried, because I did try a couple times later. Because I'm crazy. And I still tried to, like, work things out with him. And it's just, I just literally couldn't. Because it would bug me the fact that he went and he...
Yo pienso que ya estabas tú como a tu límite. Like, yeah, you went through so much with him that you're like, ya no puedo.
I'm done. Like, I'm honestly done. Like, you can leave. Like, if anything,
te abro la puerta, mi amor.
A chingar su madre. No, literally, I feel like, and I've said this before, I think maybe in like, I don't know, maybe to my friends or something. I've always told myself this, like, I literally would not be here right now if I wouldn't have left him. Because he wouldn't have, because he didn't like me doing like social media. And especially I started growing thanks to Lalo and Alan. He would have never allowed that.
He didn't like them?
No, I'm saying like he would have never allowed it.
Oh, like to be going live with them.
So I wouldn't be here right now.
You're like, so muchas gracias, mi amor.
Ah. Gracias por dejarme. Ah.
No, y gracias por inspirar tu canción, güey. No. Literal. So ahorita hablamos, you know, obviamente hablamos de esta relación, this toxic relationship that you went through. And after learning all these things that you did learn, being in that relationship, now moving forward, what are red flags que tú en cuanto miras dices, ¿sabes qué? De aquí no soy. This is not going to happen. What are the red flags that you look for in a guy now when it comes to like even going into like a talking stage?
When they have no communication skills. Because I cannot be with someone that doesn't know how to communicate. If they're not gonna talk to me, if they'd rather just ghost me, if they'd rather just not talk about it, no. Because, like, for example, like, sometimes, like, me and my ex, like, we would go to sleep mad at each other. And, like, it's like, bro, like, you don't even know if I'm gonna wake up tomorrow. Yeah. Like, you don't even know if I'm gonna be dead in my sleep or something, and this is the last time you're gonna talk to me? And he didn't give a fuck. So, like, I cannot be dating someone that doesn't know how to communicate.
Is that your only red flag?
Well, like, let's say, like, I don't know, if they breathe air, if they have a phone, I'm just
if they don't give me their password.
I need all your passwords.
But I feel like communication is really, really fucking important. Yeah. Y lo digo en la manera de que, like, that whole thing of, like, going to sleep, you know, mad, I'm very big on that. Like, I'm big, like, no. Whatever the fuck we have going on, if we're fighting, if we're arguing, we're going to fix it before we go to sleep. There's been times, like, uno con sus huevos are like, no, fuck it, me voy a dormir, like, chinga su madre, like, pa que le duela so he can see. But in my heart, I can't go to sleep. Like, no me puedo dormir y ya estoy la medianoche, like, trying to fix everything, because I'm really big on that, because uno nunca sabe qué tal que el día de mañana algo pase o no amanezcas.
No, so
te vas a ir con tu día, you're gonna go on with your life, like, not knowing that, like, the person you love and you were fighting the night before, you exactly. know? What are things that now, as everything you've learned, what are things that you do look for in a guy?
The opposite of my reflect. No, I'm just kidding. I think I look for a guy that's tall, that's handsome, that looks like a prince. No, I'm just kidding. No, I don't know. I don't know. I think I look for a guy that's like, that understands me, but that has goals. I cannot be with a man that doesn't do anything.
Anything, yeah.
Like, I have to, if I'm gonna date someone, I have to date someone que sea más ambicioso que yo. Yeah. Because I'm very ambitious. Like, yeah. I want something, like, new. Like, okay, what are we doing this? Like, we're gonna, whatever. Like, I'm always on my shit. So I need someone that's does it better than me.
So you can motivate yourself. You know, and I feel like that is important, because especially as the relationships tend to get serious, you know, when you have been in a relationship for a long time, I think ambition and the will to want something better, not just for yourself, but for you as a couple, is something that's super fucking important. Ya para terminar esta entrevista, amigas, ya vamos como las últimas tres preguntas. Yo quiero saber un poquito, obviamente te miramos con Gia. cada vez que estás aquí en Los Ángeles te vemos con Gia. Últimamente te hemos visto mucho con Fátima, pero quiero saber, y mucha gente quiere saber, how did you and Gia become friends? ¿Cómo pasó eso? ¿Cómo nació esa amistad?
Oh my God, me and Gia, dude, that's like a whole another level. That's like, I don't know. That's okay. How did we meet? Me and her met last year around August in a beach.
Okay.
So she picked. Oh, okay. Okay. So I had already been following her because, you know, she's crazy big. And then one day I was live and she joined my live. And I was like, Gia, this you, honey, or no? And it was her and she was like sending me gifts. And I was like, oh my God, she's here. Like, oh my God, Gia. And then I was like, text me, like, let's hang out. And I think she was commenting too.
Yeah.
I don't remember exactly, but we were like, just like como que planeando algún, una salidita. And then she finally texts me. We follow each other everywhere. And she goes and picks me up from where I was staying. And then we went to the beach. And that was the day that I literally, the only day that I took pictures in a bikini. And it was because I was going with her.
Like, you were like, fuck, I'll do it.
Yeah, I was like, it's Gia. I got to, like, she is her. I need to go in a bikini. Like, I need to go match her because she was.
You guys are super, like, ride or die for each other. Las miro, just from what I see on social media, it's almost, she's older, right? Like, a little older than you. Te miro, las miro a ustedes, and I'm just like, you guys literally give off, like, big sister, like, little sister energy. Porque ella te cuida a todo lo que da. Tú también, you're there for her. Do you feel like, you know, as a girl, it's super important for you to have, like, those girl really, you know, genuine friends a tu lado?
Yeah, honestly, I feel like it's really important, man. About Gia, I could talk to her. I could talk about her all day long. She's, honestly, she's like my older sister. I'm not gonna lie. She is my older sister. She, I feel like she may not know this, but like she helped me heal a heart that she didn't break. Like, honestly, that's my relationship. She's super special to me. I love her. And our friendship is actually not like, it's not really public.
Yeah.
Like, yes, we post each other sometimes. But in reality, people have no idea that me and her are, like, together 24/7.
Or like this.
They have
no
idea. Like, I sleep cuddling her. Like, you have no idea. Literally, like, we're so close. And people have no idea because we don't really put our relationship, like, public. But the thing is that, like, when we do, like, people always try to assume things. Like, people don't. They love to ruin shit for people. And, that's the reason why me and her have always been really, like, private. Not that it affects us in any way. Like, sometimes we do go live or whatever, and then, like, I don't know, people make up things or people clip things, and they make us seem, like, in a bad way. But in reality, they have no idea. Like, me and Gia were like this. Like,
I feel like that's the thing with social media. I feel like people online want to ruin whatever is good going on in your life. Tienes una relación bien bonita con ella. What do you feel like for you was that moment where you were like, you know what? This is my true, genuine friend, my ride or die.
I think the first time I seen her because, oh, and actually I have a picture I can show you. Hold on, I need to show you. If I'm gonna tell you, I'm gonna show you. So it was the first time we met, and I remember I had told her like everything that was happening in my life, because obviously this wasn't known to the public yet, but I was just telling her like everything that was happening. And then as I was telling her, we were walking around, and then we passed by like some place that had, it was like como que árboles. And then she grabbed the flower and she gave it to me. Aww. As I was telling her, and this is the flower.
That is so sweet, because sometimes it really isn't about the materialistic things. Like, that's a simple flower, you know what I mean? But it's the gesture that she's like, she's going through it. Y si esta flor le puede, like, brighten up her day, I'm gonna do it. And I see your guys' relationship. Y obviamente, I love seeing there's a picture you're always posting, a merch photo shoot. I don't know why that picture is so pretty. And I feel like it just represents you guys as friends.
Yeah.
Hablando de amistades, what are things that you look for now in friendships?
Okay, so I just meet people. Like, I just, you know, meet random people and become friends if I fuck with their vibe. But, you know, sometimes I catch myself lately doing that. I don't think I've ever mentioned, not even to Gia. Like there was this one time where I had a friend. I was back in San Antonio a couple days ago. And because I left and then came back.
Yeah.
So when I left for San Antonio for a few days, I hung out with one of my friends. And then some situation happened, and I was thinking about it, and I was like, she's not really like a close friend, she's just a friend that I hung
out with. Like an acquaintance.
And I was like, bro, like, I told her, I asked her something, and then she replied with it back. I think I wanted to take off something. I think I was saying I wanted to take off my faja, and she was kind of like telling me like no. like wait, and I was like, damn, like if Gia would have been here, she would have been like, let's go, let's
take like déjate la quito yo, amiga. Yeah. Literal.
Like, and I feel like I catch myself doing that, like sometimes, like if someone does something to me or they respond to me in a certain way, I'll be like, would Gia have done this? And if my answer is no, then
she's your standard now.
She's my standard.
Yes, tu standard, like she, see, yeah. Which is good, you know. I feel like, and that's a great thing, because obviamente tú sabes que you and Gia have a genuine friendship and you actually love her as a friend, not just because of social media. Like, you guys are genuine friends that sometimes you're like, you know what, like this is a real homegirl. If you're doing the bare minimum or not even up to par, then you ain't my homegirl.
Literally,
you
know what I mean?
Like,
no,
you ain't
she,
my friend.
Yeah, she raised my standards.
It's like that. And that's a good thing, because once you have those standards raised, you're like, okay, I'm not gonna get fucked over ever again.
Yeah, exactly. But and I don't know, I feel like the worst part is that like me and Jeff, we literally have like no pictures together. Dude, we've been knowing each other for how long? I think it's about to be 9 months since we first
no
met.
Más esa foto.
And we
por
literally
eso la sigue subiendo, amiga. Por eso.
I told Gia all the time, I'm like, bro, Gia, like every time I try to post you, it's always the same two pictures, the one where we first met and the one in the merch. Oh, you know what's crazy, that picture at the merch, we wasn't even, it was literally taken like
a candid pic, like it was a random, like off guard.
It was literally off guard. Like, it's because me and Gia, we actually my manager was there and she was recording, and me and Gia, we were like posing, and then we were like doing like a very like sexy pose, and then we both started like laughing, and then like sometimes like we just like grab on each other and like go like ah,
and it just happened.
It just
yes,
happened.
Se tomó la foto.
And I was just like ah, and then Gia was laughing too, and they got that in picture.
I feel like that's why it's such a beautiful picture, because it was such like a genuine reaction. It was just captured, like it was something that you guys normally do, like having fun, like laughing, and it was just, it just happened to get captured, you know?
Just literally,
so, hablamos de Gia, pero obviamente, últimamente te hemos visto mucho con Fátima. How did you guys meet? Because I feel like when you guys posted that first video of you guys together, it was una colaboración that was like so random, but that we needed. It was like those collabs where you're like, nada que ver, cada quien en su mundo, but when you get them together, you're like, wait,
what?
We need more of that.
Because
you just see that reaction, everybody was like living for it.
Fátima, actually, one day out of, because I've always followed her. Like, I think her, pobrecita Fátima, her account got hacked, and then she got a new one.
Mm-hmm.
And then I remember I was like already, I unfollowed the other account, I followed this one. And then out of nowhere, one random day, which was like a long time ago, by the way, when I was going live with Lalo, this was like a long time ago. So me and her have been playing this for a long time.
Yeah, yeah.
One random day I see, and you know how when someone like new follows you that you follow, it goes to like your, like
the
say
top
hi.
One. Yeah.
I'll be like, say hi to.
Or the wave. Yeah, the wave.
Fucking wave. And I seen that one day and I was like, no way. And then Fátima, she only followed like 10 people at the time. And I was like, no way, I can't believe it.
Like, I'm one of the 10.
I can't believe it. And then that's when we started talking, and I think I set it up on one of her stories, and then we finally started talking, and then we started FaceTiming, and then we made a video like a long time ago, and we posted it, but it was like me going like this, and then like this to my iPad, and then she was on the iPad. So
like
we were
a FaceTime.
Planning.
Yeah.
We were planning for a long time, and then one day I was just like, Fátima, what are you doing? I was here in LA, and she was like, oh, nothing, just here in my Detroit, you know, whatever, Michigan. And I was like, come to LA. And she was like, when? I was like, right now. And she was like, are you for real? And I was like, yeah. And then she just got her flight and came.
And that was the first time you guys met?
Yeah.
How was that? Was that scary? Obviously, you know, having the friendship online, and then when you finally meet them in person, was it scary? Were you nervous?
I think, I don't know. I don't think I was nervous, because Fátima, I've been FaceTiming her for a while now. And like, I feel, Fátima's a good person. Like, yeah. I feel like me and Fátima, like, we both like share the same type of like humor. So like I can be like mean to her, and then she'll be mean back.
And it won't be bad.
No,
like it's like,
bad.
No, bitch, we're mean to each other. Yeah.
No,
literally.
Yeah, no, actually, like I think we've had some videos like in these past few days where we were going live and we were like telling stuff to each other, but people don't know that this is how we are. No, but we also have our like sweet moments where
but
we're
like. But I feel
like
it's porque la gente se ataca con los 15 segundos que los dejas ver, you know, sin saber la relación. And I feel like also with you guys, because it was maybe to you guys it was very like, bitch, we've been knowing each other, we've been friends. But to the public, it was very much like,
¿qué?
So a huevo quieren pleito, you know, a huevo quieren desmadre.
Como que, ajá, a huevo nos quieren como que poner una contra la otra, pero that's not gonna happen because, well, first of all, like, because it's me, Gia, and Fatima, like, all three of us, like, we've all done, like, social media for a while now. So some comments are not gonna put ideas in our heads, like, oh, like, she's jealous of you. Like, no, it's not gonna work like that. One, because we're older, and two, because we've been doing this for a long time that we now understand how the industry works.
I have seen a lot of comments, you know, I've seen TikToks when you guys are getting ready, and there's people, like, talking shit, whether it's to her, to you, or to Gia. Does that ever, obviously, it doesn't affect you, but does it ever, like, te molesta que la gente piense así?
Honestly, I feel like I try not to respond too much. Yeah. Like, I'm just like, okay, like, if that's what they think, like, I can't really do nothing about it. Like, it's like, comments still get to me, but now I try to focus my mental health, like, okay, like, if I can't control it, I'm not gonna stress about it. I cannot control 2,000 comments of people just hating. I can't reply to every single one of them. I just can't.
And so I feel like that's a great mindset to have. Yo también, you know, llegas un momento en tu carrera or you being on social media where you're like, you know what, I'm gonna let whatever is present in my everyday life consume me. Ya lo demás, lo que fulano de tal is talking, what this bitch, that bitch is saying, me vale verga. Why? Because si no están en mi everyday life, si no saben what I do in the morning, how I go about my day, like, they're not important in my life. Yeah. And I feel like tienes que llegar a este momento para decir, chinga a su madre, aquí estamos. Quiero preguntarte la última pregunta que le tengo a todos. ¿En dónde te miras tú en 5 años, a tus 22 años?
Quieta. ¿Qué? ¿Voy a tener 22 en cuántos?
En 5 años. That's crazy.
Ya estoy vieja, no es cierto. I don't know. Good question, to be honest. Hopefully, I'll have a lot more music. Maybe in college. Maybe. Hopefully. Maybe.
Do you want to take your music career, like, full on?
Yeah. 100%. So, stream Dime Cuando. It comes out the 19th. Just saying. No, for real. I hope that my music career works out. If it doesn't, then I don't know, because it will.
And yes, manifest it. You got to manifest it. You could not talk down on yourself. You're like, no, si yo quiero hacer algo, lo voy a hacer y se va a hacer. What goes into, like, your inspo when it comes to your music?
Anything. Because I've always been a writer.
Oh, so you write your own music?
Yeah.
¿Te pones ahí con tu libreta o cómo le haces?
Yeah, it's like, well, how I do it is I like to, like, pick a topic, first of all, pick a beat, whatever, and then brainstorm. So, like, let's say I'm doing, like for example, the other day, I did a heartbreaking song, then I'll feel like, okay, pues, what's heartbreak? Like, dolido, amor dañado, or, like, tóxico.
Like, the main words.
Yeah, words, and then I just work around them.
So it's like a little puzzle.
Yeah, it's like a
puzzle. I could never, bitch. I used to, like, want to write music back in the day, like, when you're a kid, you know, agarras tu libreta y empiezas a anotar the lyrics of every song. And there was times where I'm like, me voy a componer una canción. But I can't. I feel like when someone knows, you're like, aw. You're like, sucks to be you. Could never be me.
No, literally.
Lo digo la manera de que, lo digo obviously playing around, but I say, like, it really is a gift that not everyone has. You know what I mean? Like, obviamente todos queremos ser artistas, cantantes, but you have everything that can make you. Obviamente, you know how to write your own lyrics. Your song, te estaba diciendo, we did a TikTok, you guys, si no lo han visto, vayan a verlo, lo subí ayer, but literally, like, your song is so catchy, like, dime cuando this part, the hard part. We were literally doing the TikTok, you guys, and I kept trabándome with that part. What was it, the
esto lo que vivimos tú y si repetimos dime cuando. Bye.
Go stream it, amigas. Pero thank you so much, amiga, por estar aquí con nosotros el día de hoy. I really enjoyed this plática contigo, de poder conocerte un poquito más. Yo sé que ya todos en casita también disfrutaron mucho de esta entrevista. I know you were super nervous in the beginning.
I was.
Pero siento que cuando calentamos motores, midway to the interview, se te quitaron los nervios.
Ya, yeah,
literal. Ay, like, otro podcast.
Otro podcast. Hit me up.
Me gustó mucho tenerte aquí. Thank you so much. If you guys want to go ahead and follow Meche on all her social medias, I will leave them linked down below as well as on the screen. Y también no se les olvide to follow me on all of mine, so you guys won't miss any future episodes. And with that being said, you guys, thank you so much for being here.
Thank you, Alanis. I love you.
And thank you guys so much for watching and listening, and I'll see you guys in the next one. Bye, guys. Yay. It was good. I loved it.